Well, happy hump day and happy Valentine's Day. And welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all do me a favor and please love up on Love Jones for me, and please make sure that you like the video on your way in the door, and don't be afraid to drop in the chat box and say hello. If you enjoy yourself while you're here, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure that you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because I can't get enough of the way y'all love on me. All right. So listen, y'all. Let me say hello to y'all, because we're starting a new book today, honey. So y'all know I'm here for a good time and not a long time, contrary to popular damn belief. Hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Michael Anderson, welcome back, darling. And I'm glad that this is your favorite place to be. Child, you just made my whole month. Check you out. Welcome. Hey, So Jazzy, thank you for being here, darling. And you too, Demetia. Oh, have mercy. I'm trying to call you Jamisha. That's another girl. But Demetia, and you too, Marva, and you too, Trill Texas, L Boogie's in the building. Honestly, Kay, hey girl, where you been? All right, you back with the jump off. Okay, well, thank you for coming back, darling. And you too, Missouri. And welcome, love, 3!0823. Now, that's the last time I'm going to say that whole thing, child. We're going to have to figure out something to call you. Well, maybe we'll just call you Love or 823. I don't know. I got to figure that one out. But welcome, and I'm glad you're here in your first live. Y'all welcome, Love, to the Speakeasy. Child, my little troublemaker wifey's here. Hey, girl. Hey, Vince. Hey, boo. Vince said, hey, auntie. And cousins and new cousins to be. All right, that's what I'm talking about. Welcome the whole family. Happy Valentine's Day. I hope y'all have a beautiful hump day on this good hump day. All right, Vince, y'all better get to humping because Vince said so. Thank you for being here, darling. Melly Mel, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. And you too, Chef Sky. Seti Said's in the building, along with Shakara and Lil Mama. And who else is here? Summer's here. Nikki T's in the building. Jasmine is here. Welcome. Thank you for being here. Y'all welcome, Jasmine. Tracy J came back. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Jess J is here. Lenora came back one more time. She must have had a good time, child. All right. I think I got everybody. Yeah, I think I got everybody, child. Let me see. Yeah, I did. All right. So let me get this time stamp, honey, so we can boogie on down the road. Where's Peanut? She said, and did. All right, now that's what I'm talking about. Okay. Oh my goodness. I don't know where Peanut is, but I'm sure she'll pop up in here in a minute. All right. I got my time stamp. So let's get it going. All right. Today we're reading Sleeping with My Mama's New Man by N'Dia Rae. And the synopsis reads, Donetta Jones, a single mother of six children, has struggled her entire life until she hit the lottery one day. Now worth millions of dollars, the world is her oyster, and she takes full advantage of her access to luxury. With her newfound fortune, she sets out to find love in a younger man, and I ain't mad at her. Donetta eventually meets Khalil Gaines, a teacher at her granddaughter's school and former basketball star. Their whirlwind romance takes on a life of itself until Donetta's daughter, Simone, grows jealous. After years of abuse from Donetta, Simone has grown tired of her mother's antics and decides to take matters in her own hands. She seeks to get revenge on Donetta by luring Khalil away, but she gets more than what she's bargained for. Mama's new man has a dark past and secrets that no one is ready to handle. Khalil has the potential to destroy this already fragile family. Will Donetta and Simone let him? This book is filled with scandals and dark secrets that'll keep you on the edge of your seat, make sure you clear your schedule because you won't be able to put this book down. This is a standalone novel with no cliffhanger. All right. So a quick reminder to the new people. Hey, Jan, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. This quick reminder is that this is a live reading interrupted by commentary and laughter. I don't know what the ratio is to that, but we read, we laugh, we comment. If that's not what you're looking for, then you're in the wrong place, okay? So please stop leaving me comments saying, it would be nice if she would just stick to the story. We don't do that over here, okay? So I'm giving you fair warning straight out the gate. It would be nice if y'all would read the description box. That is what would be nice. Because you don't have to leave a shitty comment for me. Because all I'm going to do is delete that shit now. I said what I said. So, I don't think anybody else came in. So, let's get this timestamp and we can get this book started. Prologue. Donetta. If this bitch in front of me don't hurry up and pay for her cigarettes so I can get my lotto tickets, I'm going to go off. After spending 12 hours standing on my feet working at Save-A-Lot, I'm ready to get my bottle of Patron, Domino's, and head home. But first, I need to play these numbers. Last night, I had a dream that showed me I was gonna win. Me and my daddy was walking along a beach when he whispered in my ear, 27, 18, 53, 21, 45, 8. Soon as I heard those numbers, I sprung out of bed and quickly typed them in my phone. That was a sign to play the damn lotto so that I could win and change my life for good. Papa died back in when I was 11. I think she meant back when I was 11, but she put back in when I was 11. And ever since then, I've had dreams about him. He's often visited to give me direction in life, but this time was crystal clear. I just knew if I played those numbers, then I would win. So if this bitch don't hurry up, I'm gonna lose my mind. My feet and back ached from standing up all day. Working at that store is hell for me, and I can't wait to quit. Dealing with rude customers that I couldn't cuss out took a toll on my spirit. Every time I had to bite my tongue killed me a little inside. I was tired of dealing with the public. I was tired of being around people. I just wanted to get in the house so that I could unwind on this Sunday evening. Shit, I deserve to win. As broke as I was, I worked around the clock as a shift manager at the grocery store, but it wasn't nearly enough money to keep me afloat. After having 6 children, 5 boys and 1 girl, and taking care of them on my own, I deserve to win. I'd spent most of my life caring for those kids, and now it's my time to live. Finally, it was my time to buy my ticket. With a liter of Sprite in my hand, I approached the cashier. Quickly, he ran my numbers, and after I paid, I headed out of the store and approached my hoopty that was on his last leg. Not a hoopty, y'all. I ain't heard hoopty in a minute. If you took a look at it, you could see that the wheels were about to pop off any day now. Not a hoopty on may-pop-ass tires. Oh, God. It was a silver 2007 Toyota Corolla with over 300,000 miles on it. It was only getting by on a prayer and gasoline. Any day now, it would give out, and I would have to find a way to get a new car. I was too strapped for cash to get a new car note. So, when this thing kicks the bucket, I'll be on the bus. Fuck that. I don't even know why I'm putting that into the universe. I'm hitting the lotto tonight. And when that money comes through, I'm upgrading everything in my life. I'm getting new cars, a new home, a new body. Shit, those 6 kids took a toll on my figure. I was bad back in the day, but now nothing was lifted to where it used to be. My boobs are hanging by my belly button. My stomach looks like a row of tires. God damn. Okay. My eyes are weighed down by baggage. And I looked older than what I was. But when I get this bag, I'm changing everything. Mommy makeover, fillers, and facials. I'm going to be nipped and tucked back to who I was before I started popping out those kids. 51 ain't old, and I got a lot of life to live. I know that's right, good sis. And I'm going to live it rich and fabulous. I'm going to get me a new man, a mansion, a new wardrobe, go on trips with my new man. I'm going to live it up. I can't wait. And I just know I'm going to win, too. Once I left the 7-Eleven, I went to Domino's to pick up my pizza, then to the liquor store to get my Patron. Finally, I was heading home. It was only 10 p.m., and the Powerball wasn't announced until around midnight. I had ample time to unwind and relax until my numbers were called. I knew they would be the winners. That dream felt too real. This was my time. I could feel it deep in my bones. That had to carry my weary body up the stairs of my raggedy townhouse. Back in 1993, I bought this home that was built in the 80s, and now the damn thing was falling apart. I was so ready to move, but I couldn't afford to. This house needed new carpet, a new front door, and a new mailbox. The cabinets were hanging off the hinges in the kitchen and the bathroom. Everything was just so damn raggedy. But that was coming to an end. Soon, I was going to be rich with a new boo, a new body, and a new man. The jackpot was at $50 million. After taxes, that would be about $25 million. Which was more than enough for me to finally live the way I've always dreamed. Okay, all the haters in my life, my sisters, my mama, and those hoes I work with will be livid when they see me get rich. I couldn't wait until that day finally came. Stressed, I sat on my sofa and devoured a couple of slices of pizza. I then mixed Patron and some Sprite and headed upstairs to my bedroom where I took off my clothes. I glanced at myself in the mirror, staring at all of my imperfections. A laugh escaped my lips because I knew that soon I'd be going through a transformation. After slipping into my nightgown, I checked the time, just 5 minutes before they called my number. I laid back in the bed and turned on the television, ready to receive my good news. While I waited, I scrolled Pinterest, looking at homes and decor that I couldn't wait to buy with my new money. The lavish lifestyle was calling my name. Every cell in my body pulsed with anticipation as I waited for them to call my numbers. I clutched the ticket in my hand as I waited for them to confirm that I was the latest lottery winner. My heart thumped against my sternum in excitement. I hadn't even considered the possibility that I would lose. I knew in my heart that I was a winner. That's why my heart was already jumping for joy. Finally, the white woman popped on the screen, ready to announce my winning numbers. Giddy, I watched all those white balls swirl in the machine. My numbers were in there. Slowly, they began to pop up on the screen. And the first number is 27. One by one, she called my numbers, and I grew so excited that I jumped out of bed and screamed, "Yes! Yes!" I clapped and stomped for joy. Tears streamed out of my eyes because I knew it would happen. 27, 18, 53, 21, 45, 8. Papa visited me and gave me those numbers. Now I was rich. "Thank you, Papa," I hollered. Papa was always so good to me. My mother was a different story. Raggedy heifer, but that doesn't matter because now I was rich. Today was my last day stepping foot into Save-A-Lot. I wasn't even going to shop there. No more driving that Corolla. I was going to get my body snatched. I was going to get me a new man. I was going to be one bad bitch. To celebrate, I finished another drink. I then signed the back of my lottery ticket and then slipped it into my wallet. Monday, I would sort out all of the details, but for now, I was going to get some rest. My life as I knew it was changed forever. All right, and that's the end of the prologue, child. Listen. Oh, my God. I almost got a little choked up, y'all, because I got to tell you, when you working on some shit to manifest some shit, it feels just like that. Every step you take, you feel like it's getting you closer and closer and closer to what you desire. Good googly moogly. All right. Let me see. I saw some new people come in. Hey, Shun the Beauty. Welcome, darling. Winter, welcome. This is your first live. Oh, I crack you up, child. I just be being me. I'm glad that cracks you up, though. Y'all welcome, Winter, to the Speakeasy. I don't know where this book is set in, Kay. I have no idea. I have no idea. Buck, who likes to fuck? Where you been? We've been looking for you, child. You been fucking. Let me get out your business. We just want to know, though. Tell us, have you? Anyway, welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey, Mary's Chit Chat. Welcome back, darling. Thank you for being here as well. I appreciate you. Y'all know I'm crazy to the motherfucker. Any fucking thing come out my mouth. My bad, y'all. And really not, because I'm going to be me. Shit. Fuck you come to YouTube for other than to be your damn self. All right. So I got my time stamp, child. I'm going to wet my whistle and then I'll get back to reading to y'all. I hope this lady have a good time with her money. Chapter 1. Blue. Avon was the finest boy in my class. Standing at 6'4" and built unlike any other boy in our school, he was the one I yearned for. A pair of dimples dented his cheeks whenever he smiled, which drew all the bitches in. Everyone wanted to be his girl. They all longed to be wrapped up in his strong, dark arms, kissed on their necks by his juicy lips, and finger-fucked under the bleachers. But luckily, I was the one he had chosen. I'd been crushing on him since we were freshmen, but he never gave me the time of day. Not until my best friend, Sharmika, told her boyfriend, Tamir, who told Avon, that I was feeling him. Tamir and Avon were best friends and also played on the basketball team together. With Sharmika being my best friend, I was finally going to get a chance. That's all I needed all of these years, just a couple degrees of separation. "Where are you meeting Avon?" Sharmika asked me as we walked side by side to our lockers. I'm waiting for him to text me. School was finally out and I couldn't wait to link up with Avon. I'd been thinking about it all night long. I didn't even get any sleep. Just to be ready, I wore a red lacy bra and panty set underneath my uniform. I wasn't a virgin, and I knew what the boys in our school expected. I never wanted Avon to run back and tell people that I wore raggedy or dirty drawers, or that I had wild pussy hair peeking out of my panties. Not wild pussy hair. Wait a minute, ma'am. Sounds like a jungle drama. Hold on, child. Therefore, last night, I shaved every strand off. Oh, child. It was now bald and ready for whatever. He wouldn't be the first boy that I've hooked up with. I've hooked up with three boys since I lost my virginity last summer to Micah Johnson. That day remained vivid in my mind. Sharmika was messing with Micah's cousin, Lorenzo, at the time. It was at the end of the summer, and none of us had anything to do. Char and I had jobs at Rite Aid, but we were only able to get 15 hours a week of work. We had a lot of time on our hands. To kill time, Char and I would smoke weed when my mama was at work. Eventually, we started buying you from Lorenzo. He was 19 years old and had his own car. I was so jealous of Char when they started talking. Since she and I couldn't drive, we were limited to where we could go. But when she got with Lorenzo, she was able to go everywhere. One night, Lorenzo got a hotel room so that we could all chill and smoke in. He brought along his cousin, Michael, who was 20 years old. At the time, I was 16. Him being older than Lorenzo was a win in my book. Plus, he looked better. As soon as I saw his tatted athletic body, my little pussy was screaming. I knew that he was the one that I wanted to give it to. That night, I lost my virginity to Micah. We had sex a few other times afterward, but eventually he had to go back to college. Unfortunately, I haven't heard from him since, but that didn't stop me from finding a new nigga to hook up with. After Micah was Troy, and then DeAndre, and now finally my dream man, Avon. "Did you shave?" Sharmika asked me after she opened her locker and slid her books inside. Char had a light toffee complexion, long wavy hair, and a pair of hazel eyes that drove all the boys crazy. Being pretty got her lots of attention from everyone, students and teachers. "Yeah," I replied. "We befriended each other out of shallow reasons. We both had naturally long hair, but eventually our friendship blossomed into something real. We've done everything together, from getting jobs to smoking weed for the first time." "Damn, that new frontal is cute. I forgot to tell you that this morning," she said, eyeing the freshly plucked wig glued to my head. "Thanks. Grandma got my hair done this weekend. I flipped my tresses." I think she meant tresses, but she put stresses. Child, listen. Despite having hair, I love switching it up in wigs so that I could experiment with different colors and cuts. This wig was ombre. Fading from brown to blonde. Man, I wish my grandma would hit the damn lottery. Shit, now I'm over here stacking my Rite Aid coins for these Gucci flats I saw Sweetie wearing. "I ain't seen no bitch in Henley High with them on," she said, as she scrolled through her phone to show me a picture. "Those are cute. You would definitely stand out with those. How much are they?" $1,100. "How much you got saved?" $750. "Ask your grandma to get me a pair," she laughed. "I got you. She might let me take her card this weekend. We can go shopping together at Tyson's," I answered her. As soon as the words left my lips, my phone vibrated. Desperately, I checked and was ecstatic to find that it was Avon. "Hey, meet me in the boys' bathroom by the tech center," his message read. "What did he say?" Char asked me while peering over my phone. "Damn, bitch, back up," I laughed. "Fuck that. I want to know what got you smiling ear to ear. You look like the nigga just asked you to marry him." "He just wants me to meet him by the tech center." "Oh, he probably want to finger you or some shit. Those ballers do that shit. Let me see how tight you are. Once he fingers you, he'll probably want to date you. Your shit tight. You ain't been with that many boys. Unlike that girl, Kaisha." she rolled her eyes. Kaisha was a thot that half the school had hooked up with, including Sharmika's boyfriend, Tamir. I think she meant a thot, but she just put thot. Tamir told everybody that Kaisha's pussy was wide, that he could hear echoes when he was inside. Listen, maybe her pussy ain't wide and you just got a little dick, sir. The fuck? We ain't finna be love canal shaming, nigga. Several other boys confirmed it. They had little dicks too. Fuck them. Whenever that girl walked down the hall, somebody yelled, "Loose wall, all, to mimic an echo. Damn. Kids are brutal. Teenagers are fucking brutal. Oh my God. To mimic an echo, y'all. If I were that girl, I would have asked to be transferred. But we're seniors, so I guess it's too late for that. You think he gonna ask me to his girl? I think she meant to be his girl. Where the fuck is the missing letters at? Hell yeah, you pretty. You hook up your uniform real nice. You got a banging body even under these ugly ass skirts. If you tell him you rich, he really gonna wanna fuck with you, she laughed. I do not want people in my business like that. I don't want people liking me because they think I got some money. You gotta promise me you'll never tell. I won't. I was your best friend well before all of that. We're sisters. Now go meet your man, ho, and tell me all about it. I'm about to go smoke at Tamir's house since his mama don't get off work until 11. Call me if you want to come through. Cool. Maybe me and Avon will stop by, I laughed. Okay. We waved goodbye as I walked towards the tech center, which was on the lower level of the school. I knew why he chose that bathroom. It was in a secluded area away from all of the after-school programs, which were all located on the upper level. As I walked down the stairs, my heart started to pound in my chest. I could feel the heat rising from my core, spreading throughout my flesh. I'd been focused on Avon for so long, but he was in a relationship with this cheerleader for the last year. They'd been broken up for about 3 months now, and he finally was noticing me. I couldn't hide my excitement, even if I tried. After what seemed like a journey passing lockers and unused water fountains, I finally arrived to the bathroom where he stood, leaning against the wall, head lowered, focused on his iPhone. Well, we know he trash. He got a fucking iPhone. But anyway, even in the navy slacks, white shirt, and navy tie, he looked sexy. I hated that we had to wear uniforms because it took away from our creative expression, but I loved the way that he looked in his. Avon had a fade that led to dark waves on top of his head. I'd often imagined what it would be like to see him between my legs, tasting me, and today I was probably going to find out. Avon, I called out his name. Sup, shawty? He looked up from his phone. A sexy grin played across his face as he eyed me up and down. Glad you texted me. Yeah, I ain't know you liked me until Tamir told me. I've seen you around and always thought you were cute. Why you ain't say nothing, I asked, standing on my hip. Cause I had a girl, but I'm free now, so what's up, he asked as he slid his phone into his pocket. What do you want to do? Tamir and Shah are smoking right now. I don't smoke. Really? Hell no. I'm going into the NBA. I gotta keep my lungs in top shape. Me and Tamir don't have the same goals, so no smoking for me, sweetheart. True. What else do you have in mind then? Shit, let's slide in there for a second. If you cool, then maybe we could kick it at my house later this week, he said, motioning towards the bathroom. I shrugged. I knew he was testing me. He wanted to see if I was one of those bougie girls that played hard to get. Nobody wanted to fuck with those girls. They acted like they were scared of dick, but I wasn't scared. After fucking three boys, I was pretty good at taking dick. I knew what to do with it. Learned how to arch my back right. Learned how to grip him when he slid it in. I even knew how to ride and suck. I wouldn't say I was a pro, but I knew my way around the dick. And I most certainly wasn't afraid of it. And when it came to getting something I wanted, I knew how to go after it. And I wanted Avon badly. We could be a power couple at Henley High. Him, a star basketball player. Me, one of the flyest girls in the school. I was a good catch. Pretty mahogany skin covered my curvaceous body. Even though I couldn't rock the clothes I wanted, I wore the best accessories. Grandma had gotten me a black Birkin to go with my uniform, and on my feet, I sported a pair of Fendi slides. Diamonds dripped from my wrists and ears. No other bitch was seeing me in this school, and soon I'd be getting my Mercedes truck. Grandma promised that when I got my license, she would get it for me. I passed the test last week. Let's go before someone comes down here, I said, smiling from ear to ear. Aye, he replied. We checked to make sure the coast was clear before we snuck into the bathroom. He walked me into the handicapped stall where he closed the door behind us, assuring our privacy. In a stall, girl. His tongue dragged across his lips as he eyed me up and down. Without a word uttered, he pressed his lips into mine. Our tongues twisted into one another as we kissed in the bathroom. He then slid his fingers up my skirt and trailed the skin above my panties. And I'm gonna skip all of this because y'all know that I don't fuck around with reading this type of bullshit. So anyway, in the midst of all of this, he asks her how many boys she's been with, and she tells him just one. And she says, I lied. And he says, yeah, I can tell. He asks her, does she give head? And he tells her, let me see. And she asks, right now? And he says, yeah, unless you're scared. And she says, no. And I'm gonna keep going because I'm not reading that. And I hope y'all understand why I don't. So somebody came in the bathroom while they were in there. And she didn't hear them come in. And she says, but I most certainly heard whoever's in here has 1 minute to exit this bathroom. It was a man's voice, one that I recognized. Fuck, it was Mr. Gaines. Shit. Avon jumped as he pushed me off of him. We're fucked, I muttered, as I quickly stood to the floor. Nah, I'm gonna go out first. That's Mr. Gaines. He's my assistant coach. Let me just talk to him for a second. Okay, I replied. My heart had lunged to my throat and I could barely breathe. I was so embarrassed that I was caught on my knees at school. Well, now y'all can kind of get a little understanding of what she was doing. I prayed that Avon was able to talk to Mr. Gaines and lure him away from the bathroom. I should have just taken my ass home. This is what I get for being so eager to be with Avon. I should have told him we needed to do this at his house or mine, but no, I just had to do that to him at school. I just couldn't wait. Ugh. I was on the verge of crying when I heard, Miss, you need to come out right now. From the sound of it, it didn't sound like Avon was able to talk Mr. Gaines down. Ashamed and flustered, I smoothed out my uniform and walked outside of the bathroom. On the outside stood Mr. Gaines and no one else. Avon was nowhere to be found. What in the fuck? Come to my office now, Mr. Gaines instructed. It seemed as if the walk took forever. My head was too heavy to hang high, and I could feel that tears wanted to escape my cheeks at any time, but I held them in. Mr. Gaines was about to call my mother, and that's the last thing that I needed. I didn't want to hear her voice about the situation, and I didn't feel like her trying to be a mom and put me on punishment. She was more like my big sister than my mom at this point, but I knew that she would try to punish me just like she did when she found out I was having sex. She came across some condoms that I had gotten from my job at Rite Aid. When she found them and questioned me, she told me I couldn't hang out with Char for a month. That shit lasted no more than a weekend. Mama partied and fucked a lot herself, so she ain't had time to keep track of me. When I arrived to Mr. Gaines's office, I plopped down in the chair across from his desk. Mr. Gaines was an administrator at our school and the assistant coach for the basketball team. All the girls liked his ass. He was youngish, tall, fit, and had a dark beard that framed his chin. His hairline was always perfect. He had nice white teeth and a voice with a nice baritone. Even with all that, there was something about him that I hated. I couldn't put my finger on it, but he got on my damn nerves. I think it was because he knew he looked good. He acted like he was the finest nigga on earth, and it annoyed me to no end. So many girls in my school liked him and even threw pussy his way. But as far as I could tell, he didn't cross that line. What's your name again? He asked as he settled behind his desk. What happened to Avon? I asked. Another administrator took him. He's getting written up too. Suspended from at least 3 games. Oh, what's your name? He asked, his deep voice filling the room. Blue Jones. All right, so Blue, I'm writing you up for inappropriate misconduct. I'm going to spare the details, but you'll be required to come to detention for a week, okay? Yeah, I sighed. I have to call your parents. Parent, I corrected him. Your mother? Yes. Before I make that call, I just want to say that it's not becoming of a young woman to be caught in a situation like that. It's inappropriate for you to be doing that on school grounds. People will lose respect for you when they think that you're loose. Do you understand? I wondered if whoever was calling Avon's parents was giving him the same lecture about inappropriateness. We were both in that stall, and had we had more time, he would have been I think she meant going down, but she put doing down. He would have been going down on me too. Trust and believe, would people lose respect for him? I understand, I replied, while I waited for him to call my mother. He looked up her information in the computer system, then placed the call while I waited impatiently. My stomach twisted in knots. As my eyes wandered around the office, the puke green tile on the floor looked like it hadn't been changed since the 70s. The buzz of the overhead fluorescent lights was unnerving. I wanted to rip them out of the ceiling because they were driving me crazy. However, I simply sat there, biting the inside of my cheek. It was only October, and when I looked out of the window, I could see the orange and yellow leaves falling to their demise. That's exactly how I felt right now, falling to the ground, to be trampled on. Hello, Mrs. Simone Jones. I'm sorry, Ms. This is Mr. Gaines from Henley High. Your daughter. He spoke to my mother, explaining as delicately as possible that he caught me doing something in the bathroom after school. She said what she was doing. I'm not. Shame washed over me like a bucket of ice. Goosebumps stood on my skin as I listened to my mother and him talk. I could barely hear what she said, but I knew that I would be able to hear her clearly tonight. After about 5 minutes of talking, Mr. Gaines hung up the phone and redirected his attention to me. Your mother can't get out of work right now, but she's sending your grandmother to come get you. I sucked my teeth as soon as he spoke. My mother only asked for my grandmother to come get me to further shame me. Grandma didn't have to be involved in my business like that. Why can't I just walk home? That's now how that, oh, I think she meant not. Fuck these errors. That's not how that works, but she put now. You're a smart young lady. Act like a lady and don't put yourself in that position again, he replied as he corrected his tie. Pause. Let me just say for the record, that girl wasn't in that bathroom by herself, okay? So don't chastise her without chastising him. You should have brought both of their asses in the same room so you could talk to them both. But the way it sounds, it's coming off like you're saying something is wrong with her. Well, she can't do what she was doing in there by her fucking self. So you got to tell his ass, because it was his fucking suggestion to go in there, good sir. Anyway, time ticked slowly as I waited for my grandmother to come pick me up. I hated that she would know I was doing something at school. I hated that I had to sit across from the man who caught me. I just wanted this day to be over, but it was only 4 p.m. There were so many hours left. As I waited for my grandma to come, I looked down at my phone and saw that Char had texted me. So Sharmika says, how did it go? And she says back to her, tell you later. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. If this is what we about to get, y'all know I will throw a book away. Zero fucks given. No God. All right, let me go back and I saw some people come in. Let me see. Hey, Danielle. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Okay, Buck. I'll accept that excuse for now, but I think you've been somewhere fucking and you just ain't told us, but that's all right. We love you just the same. Welcome back. All right, let me see. I saw somebody else, I thought. I'm still going. Demo, there you go. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Jasmine Elaine, welcome. Let me see who else. Cece, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Glad you're finally able to catch a live. Welcome. Y'all welcome, Cece. Hey, Cleopatra, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, so I got everybody. Let me get the timestamp, child, because I don't know, shit, we might be dropping this book like a hot pocket and picking up something else if it don't get no better than this, because I don't like how it's fucking starting out, but I guess something had to happen to get Grandma and Mr. Gaines to meet, so okay. Chapter 2, Donetta. It's been 6 months since I hit that lottery. Becoming a multimillionaire overnight has brought me more joy than being a mother to 6 kids. Whoever said you can't buy happiness with money never had $25 million to their name. Some broke bitch must have said that, because I've been so happy ever since I started fucking up commas. Isn't that what the kids say? As soon as I got my winnings, I got my makeover. I wasted no time to hop a first-class flight to the Dominican Republic. Now I have a body better than most 20-year-olds. My breasts sit up nice and perky. My waist has been cinched to 27 inches, and my ass and hips have been expanded to 45 inches. Not to mention, I've gotten cheek, under eye, and lip fillers. I look nothing like the women my age, and the bitches I used to hang with hate it. Ha! I've been so happy with this new body of mine. People are friendlier now that I don't look like something a truck ran over. When I walked into a fine establishment, the associates rushed to my side to help me. Why? Because I look like money. I look like wealth. I embody it every step I take and every time I talk. And the men, I turn heads wherever I go. Men honk their horns at me. I haven't heard that confirmation that I was fine since my second child. They hold doors, buy drinks, and clamor for my attention. I've been on several dates and have had a boy toy or two since I got my body redone. However, I'm still looking for a main boo. Today, I was getting a pedicure. I'd spent all day with my interior decorator going over the finishing touches for the new home I'm getting built. She wore me out, showing me all those color swatches and furniture. We've been all over town looking at sofas and coffee tables. It was now time for me to unwind with a pedicure and a glass of wine at one of the luxurious nail salons in D.C. Okay, so she's in D.C., not Chicago. All right. Before hitting the lottery, I could never afford to come to a place like this. The pedicure started at $100. No way in hell I could afford that before I hit it big. The only time I would go to the spa is when my kids would give me a gift certificate for Mother's Day. That was only once a year. It was nice, but not nearly enough to make me feel good and keep my toes pretty. But since getting my winnings, I've been going to the spa every week. I loved getting pampered, and I deserved it. Just as the nail tech slipped the UV light over my feet so that the gel polish could dry, I got a call from my daughter, Simone. Of all the children I've had, Simone was my only girl. And she was a problem child. All of my kids were problem children. A few were in prison, but that Simone went out of her way to be difficult. This is Ms. Donetta Jones speaking. I answer the phone regally. Mama, can you stop answering the phone like that? You know it's me. This is how moneyed people speak, little girl. Now, what do you want? I'm getting my toes done. I need you to pick up Blue from school. She's in Mr. Gaines's office. What's going on with my grandbaby? I sat up from the butter leather reclining chair. Blue was my heart and soul, my only granddaughter, the apple of my eye. I would do anything for my baby girl. She could do no wrong in my eyes. Perfect in every way, unlike her mama. She was caught giving head in the bathroom after school, Simone said flatly, as if she took some pleasure in crushing my spirit about my granddaughter. What? Yeah, your precious granddaughter was on her knees in a nasty-ass school bathroom doing that, Simone replied with a hint of a grin in her voice. Well, I wonder where she got that behavior from, I smirked. Guess you can ask her when you pick her up. I can't leave work right now. I'm the only manager available. You're not doing anything but getting plucked and painted, so please pick up your favorite grandchild. Oh, I'm on my way, and I can't wait to talk some sense into her. I have to prevent her from going down the road your fast ass traveled. Had a baby at 17 and didn't even know who the father was. Nasty. I know you're not talking. Simone started, but I swiftly ended the call. She hung up in her face before she could snarl shit. Lord have mercy. Hey, Kim Cash. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Lord, you can't call your mama out on her shit, girl. Don't you know she'll hang up on you? Luckily, she called me right as my pedicure was finishing. As soon as I paid, I hopped into my new red Tesla to go scoop my baby up from school. Doing that in the bathroom. Hearing those words made my heart sink. There's only one place she could learn such behavior, from her whore of a mother. I swear when Simone was in school, I was getting calls all the time about her nasty ass. She came out of my coochie fast-tailed. That little heifer was trying to kiss boys as early as 3 years old, and it got worse from there. Her brothers have told me that they've caught her sneaking boys into the house. She was always messing with someone after hell. During school. Just nasty for no reason. I ain't raised her like that, but she still turned out to be a mess. When she was 16, I noticed she was gaining weight. By the way her nose was spreading across her face, I knew that she was pregnant. I forced her to pee on a stick. Once it was confirmed, I dragged her ass down to the clinic, but they said she was too far along. She'd been hiding her pregnancy for a few months. I didn't want her to have blue. I didn't want Simone making the same mistakes that I did, but she did anyway. My life was hard because I had Simone at 17. Then I went on to have 5 more kids. I wanted more for Simone. But you know what they say, you can't want more for someone than they want for themselves. Despite being disappointed in Simone, I was happy when Blue was born. She was such a sweet baby. But now I see that Blue is going down the same road as her mama. I want Blue to go to college. She's smart enough. She gets good grades and has stayed on the honor roll. I know she smokes weed from time to time because I can smell it on her, but I look the other way. I don't say nothing because her GPA stays up. But doing that in the bathroom at school, that's a big fat hell no. Finally, I arrived at Blue's school. I whipped my sexy Tesla in a parking spot and switched my fine ass towards the building. I had on a pair of ornate Versace leggings, a matching blouse, and a pair of Versace heels. Gold jewelry adorned my body to complement the look. As I walked through the hall, I caught a glimpse of my ass in one of the glass trophy cases. God damn, I'm fine. Ooh, she sound like me in the morning. Anyway, that money was well spent. I was looking fly like Marjorie Harvey. Girl, pick a better role model, Donetta, because that ain't it, boo. Mm-mm. Every morning, I beat my face to perfection, and today I had my hair pulled into a top knot. Just a year ago, my scalp was thinning, but I started getting these platelet-rich plasma injections that have my tresses growing like I was 25. Excuse me, hon, where's Mr. Gaines's office? I asked the janitor as he swept up pencil shavings and love notes the kids had passed. Down the hall to the left. He tripped over his words as he admired my beauty. Another stroke to my ever-growing ego. Thank you, I replied, as I fixed the Versace purse strap that was sliding down. I could feel his eyes following my fat ass while I walked to Mr. Gaines's office. I was going to have a serious talk with Blue about her antics. This was an embarrassment to me as much as it was for her. Who the hell wants to pick up their granddaughter from school because she was caught doing that in the bathroom? If you gonna hoe on the low. Wait a minute. Not hoe on the low. One second, y'all. Okay, yeah. Did she say, hold on, Demo. Let me see what it says here. No, she's got 6 kids. She's a single mother of 6 children. I had to check. That's what the synopsis says. She got 6 kids. When I came across the office, the door was wide open. I saw Blue's eyes lowered, focused on her phone. Mr. Gaines was sitting behind the computer typing away. This Mr. Gaines was something to behold. His skin was a smooth, creamy caramel complexion, and he had a beautiful, healthy beard that I would love to dip in my wop. I could tell by his hands that he lifted weights. That man was all types of gorgeous just from the peek that I was getting from the hallway. Excuse me, I'm here to pick up Blue, I spoke as I entered the room. Oh, good afternoon, Ms. Jones, I sang as I extended my hand. He gripped it firmly, sending a wave of chills down my spine. It was rough and strong, just as I expected. Just the touch of his hand sparked my curiosity about the rest of his body. You're Blue's grandmother? My God, you look like a big sister, he complimented. Good genes, I winked. Blue, step outside, baby, so that I can speak to Mr. Gaines. Fine, she spoke as she sauntered off. Here we go. I didn't get the whole story from her mother, but I wanted to talk to you about her behavior, I said to Mr. Gaines as he closed the door behind me, leaving Blue in the hallway. To be honest, I didn't care to talk about her. I really wanted to talk to him about us. That man was too damn fine to be working at a high school. He needed to be on TV. There was something about him that reminded me of Omari Hardwick. Okay, so now we see how he looks. Okay, I got you. Because that Omari Hardwick is fine, child. Well, Blue was caught in a compromising situation in a bathroom with a male student. We have a zero tolerance for that kind of behavior. Typically, students are suspended, but since it happened after school, I've decided to only give her detention. Please talk to her about that type of behavior. Something like that could ruin her reputation. His deep voice filled my ear. His voice was sultry and weighted. It was like a good wine flowing through my body. I'd love to hear his voice while he made love to me. I wasn't leaving here without us exchanging information. It was about time that I replaced my current boy toy, Jordan. He was my personal trainer, but I can get a new one anytime. Oh, I'm aware. She's definitely getting placed on punishment. I promised her a G-Wagon, but she can forget about that now. No more shopping sprees, nothing. Thank you for not suspending her. I'd hate for something like this to be on her permanent record. She's a smart girl, and she's going to college. Yes, I looked at her file. It surprised me. We usually don't see our best students acting out like that. I'm nipping it in the bud. Thank you, Mr. Gaines, I said while extending my hand. Oh, you can call me Khalil. You're not a student, he grinned. I could tell that he was feeling me just by the way his words melted off his tongue. Well, Khalil, here's my card. Please use it if anything else comes up. I know I'm not a student, but I can still learn from you. I handed him my business card. I had them printed a week ago. They were for the real estate company I was developing. Even though I was having fun, spending my funds, I wanted the money to work for me. I hired a financial consultant and already invested half of the lottery winnings. And now I was in the market to buy a small apartment building. You're in real estate? Yes, I guess we can learn from each other, he replied while licking his lips. I look forward to it. I'll definitely be calling you. Have a good day, Ms. Jones. Donetta, I corrected him. Right, he smiled as I turned and walked out of the office. When I opened the door, I saw Blue leaning against the locker on her phone. If she thought she was going to still be on the phone after the stunt she just pulled, she had another thing coming. Hand me that. What? The question was filled with so much attitude. Your phone. Oh, here, she handed it to me, almost dropping it on the floor. You need to change that nasty attitude right now. You're already in trouble as it is. Together, we walked over the linoleum floor as we made our way through the school. The hallways were vacant. Not even the janitor was still there. When I checked my Audemars child, I know I'm broke because I don't even know how to fucking say this word. Anyway, some kind of AP watch. I saw that it was 5. Simone didn't get off from work until 10, since she worked as a manager at Dollar Tree. Can you believe that heifer had the nerve to ask me to retire her when I won the lottery? I said, hell no. You gotta work like everybody else. I did give her my townhouse, though, and promised to rehabilitate it. I didn't want Blue still living in that raggedy neighborhood they were living in before I won. Can we stop at McDonald's? I'm starving. If you'd gone straight home after school, you'd be eating, so no. Come on, Grandma. I said, no, I'm not rewarding bad behavior. Fine, I'll just order from Uber Eats, she said when she opened the Tesla door. I slipped into the driver's side and put my seatbelt on. You're coming to the hotel with me. I'm not letting you go home where you have no supervision. Nope, that's over. I'm going to be picking you up from school every day from here on out. You can order something at the hotel. What? That's not fair, she whined. No more hanging with that hot-tail Sharmika, neither. That girl ain't got nothing but dick on her brain. What kind of teenager has a tongue ring, huh? A dick-sucking one. She got that thing to suck dick, and you just on some monkey-see-monkey-do shit. She sucks dick, so you gotta suck dick, too? Oh, my God, she hissed. Don't bring God into this. If you had God in your heart, you wouldn't have been caught on your knees doing anything else but praying. A chorus of teeth-sucking, angry seatbelt rattling and sighing ensued. I didn't care, though. She can act mad all she wanted, but I was serious about her not hanging with Sharmika anymore. That little girl was nothing but trouble. Ever since she was little, I could see it in her eyes. And another thing. What now? Blue had the audacity to ask, as if I were bothering her. You should at least be humble. You got caught doing that in the bathroom, and you still can't be humble. And as for your what now, I'm not getting that damn G-Wagon. What? You promised, she fussed. You didn't uphold your end of the bargain. You said if I kept my GPA above a 3.5, I could get it. Grades aren't everything. You're gonna learn that, little girl. Whatever, she scoffed while staring outside the window. Finally, we arrived at the Royal Blue, a hotel that I was staying in while my new home was being built. I decided to get a brand new mansion built in the gated community of Woodmore. It's been 4 months, but I had 4 to go. I decided that I wanted to live in the Royal Blue for a while, but in a month, I was going to rent an apartment until my home was finished. As soon as those numbers hit, I knew I wasn't going to stay in that townhouse anymore. I hated that home. Shit, that house had been through so much. I bought it back in the early 90s, and in that time, it's been raided several times because of my sons. 3 of them are criminals, and now they're in prison for various offenses. My oldest son, Rayshawn, 33 years old, is in for life, for murder. Stefan, 31 years old, is doing 15 years for drug possession. Evan, 29 years old, is in for 7 years for robbery. Those boys were a headache, but I loved them. I made sure to put money on their books and write them often. My other younger sons were doing better. Keith, who's 24, works in the entertainment industry. I'm not really sure what he does, but he's always posted on IG traveling and hanging out with celebrities. And Blake, my youngest son, he's 22. He's my only gay child and the best behaved. I ain't never had no problems out of Blake. He's also the only son whose father was active. Blake wasn't primarily raised by me. He'd spend the weekends, summers, and some holidays with me, but his father fought for custody. Blake is currently a pre-med student at Johns Hopkins University. His ultimate goal is to become a plastic surgeon. That's the child I'm most proud of, and he's the only one that doesn't have kids. The rest of my sons have had sons all over the place, and their raggedy baby mothers always calling asking me for money. I tell them, hell no. If I gave them all money, I'd be broke again. I'll treat my grandbabies here and there, but I ain't gonna raise them. I made a lot of mistakes in my past, but going forward, I was gonna live my life to the fullest, but responsibly. And now that I've gotten this Royal Blue Hotel out of my system, it's time for me to rent an apartment and save my coins. However, I've always wanted to stay here since I was a little girl. Mama used to take us here to have lunch sometimes, and I was so enamored. The hotel has a nautical theme. It's like being on a cruise ship, but on land. It was a childhood dream to stay here, and I have for months. Good evening, Miss Jones, the bellhop greeted me when he opened the door. Good evening, Jason, I smiled as I walked through. Blue was right behind me, still seething from finding out that she wouldn't be getting her G-Wagon. I didn't care. The only way she could get one out of me now is if she graduates with honors and the rest of the year is perfect. Then she can have it as a graduation gift. Finally, we arrived at my hotel suite where I stepped out of my Versace heels to let my new pedicured feet breathe. Look through that menu and order something to eat, I said to her when I eased into the leather chair and turned on the TV. Without a word from her lips, she began peering through the menu. It was better than McDonald's, in my opinion. I guess dick-sucking taste buds would prefer that garbage. I'm gonna have a stern conversation with my daughter when she comes to pick her up. This is not my baby Blue. Simone has rubbed off on her in the worst way. And that's the end of that chapter. You peeped that, huh, Jasmine? Right, the only successful one is the one that wasn't raised by her, or at least alone. Yeah, that's the only one that had an active father. So, yeah, now he's pre-med. But, I mean, and that's saying a lot for, like, the average kid, but there are a lot of pre-med students who are raised by single parents. And some of them don't even have a village like a grandma or a couple of good ass aunties or, you know, grandparents that give a fuck or anything like that. All right. So I got my time stamp, child. All right. So after this chapter, I'll ask y'all, what are you thinking? Did anybody else come in here? Bella, Bella, I thought I saw you, boo. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right. Well, hello, Butterfly Cassie. Welcome. She said, just stopping in to say, hi, Saki. Love your channel. You got me into audiobooks. I've done 3 books on your channel. Nice to meet you, girl. Well, nice to meet you too, boo. And welcome. Y'all welcome, Butterfly Cassie, to the Speakeasy. Okay, I got Kim Cash already. Okay, so I think Bella Bella was the only one to come in. All right, so let me... I gotta redo this fucking timestamp since my stupid ass was running my mouth. All right, so y'all gotta hang on. Yes, because this is a live reading, child. So shit happens during the live stream that you wouldn't expect. Oh Lord, y'all, hold on. I'm supposed to wake my son up 26 minutes ago. Damn it! Hold on, y'all. I'll be right back. Okay, sorry, y'all. Hell, he was already up. I didn't hear him stomping around upstairs, but whatever. I had to do what he asked me to do, which was wake him up. Y'all listen, we all sleep through alarm clocks around here. We be setting a damn alarm, but y'all listen, that shit don't work. So he was up though. So he's like, wake me up in case I sleep through my alarm. But that's what happened when you be up all night. Something about sleeping in the day to make your ass oversleep. All right, here we go. Chapter 3, Simone. After I finished counting the registers for the evening, I locked everything up and headed out so that I could pick up my crazy-ass daughter from my mother's hotel. Bye, Simone. Leah, one of the store associates, spoke to me as we headed in separate directions. See you tomorrow, Leah, I replied. Even though I wished I could call in sick, I hated my job. Every day spent there made me age and grow bitter. I'd been working at the Dollar Tree since Blue was born. With a GED and no help to go to college, I didn't have that many options. I worked my way into management, but it wasn't enough money. And every time I've tried to go to college, something comes up. I'm only 34, and Blue is about to finish high school, so I'll have the time soon. I'll try once she's out of my house and in college. Who knows? Maybe we can graduate together. When I closed the door to my black 2010 Honda Civic, okay, now it makes sense. She drives a Honda Civic, child. All right. I'm going to hell. I quickly lit the blunt that was hiding in my glove compartment for me. Girl Scout cookies mixed with OG Bubba Kush was surely going to relax my mind after that long day of standing on my feet and dealing with customers. I was exhausted, and the fact that I had to go deal with my daughter's shit was stressing me even more. Just as I started the car, I received a phone call from Dion, a nigga that I was messing with from time to time. Hey, I said when I answered the phone. You just got off? Uh-huh, I said as I puffed the blunt. Slide through. Wifey out of town for a few days. I miss your pussy. His voice filled my ear. As tempting as it was, I had to go handle my daughter. I can't tonight. Why not? I got a situation with my daughter, I replied as I exhaled the smoke. Moment by moment, every fiber in my body began to relax. All of my fucks were slowly leaving my system. It still wasn't enough to neglect Blue to go ride Dion's dick. Fuck that shit. She's 17. She dying? Nah, it ain't like that. Then deal with it tomorrow. Come over and let me fuck you while you high. I can hear you smoking through the phone. Seriously, Dion, I can't. And if your wife is going to be out of town for a few days, why can't I come tomorrow? I got shit to handle tomorrow. You mean another bitch to handle? I ain't trying to hear all that. You fucking tonight or nah? I can't. Cool, he replied, before swiftly ending the call. Fuck! I hit my fist against the steering wheel. Dion has some bomb dick that always made my troubles fade away. We'd been sleeping with each other off and on for a few months. I met him one night while me and my homegirl Stacy was out at the bar. I saw that wedding ring on his finger, but I paid it no mind. I didn't want to be his girl. I just wanted a taste of the over 6 foot, dark-skinned beast of a man. But he was cocky and disrespectful. It was about time that I cut him off anyway. He only could get with me when wifey wasn't around. I needed consistency to feed my appetite. I've always had a strong sex drive, and I hate when a nigga can't keep up. Me too, girl. Anyway, shit, I guess my daughter got one too. She couldn't even wait to leave school to do that in the bathroom. That shit is so embarrassing. At least when I was in school, I did my dirt off of the premises. Now I gotta go talk some sense in her head. And on top of it, I gotta hear my mother's mouth. I was not in the mood for her bullshit. She was always a piece of work, but now that she's won the lottery, she is the absolute worst. Every time I turn around, she finds a way to throw her newly found coins in my face. It was so obnoxious. It ain't like she earned it. See, that's the mistake that family members make. As soon as you get some money, they fucking feel like they can comment on it and say shit like, it ain't like you earned it, bitch. Whether I earned it, it fell in my lap, it fell off the back of a truck, or it came out of my asshole when I farted. It's mine, and I don't owe you a motherfucking lick of it. The fuck? What type of shit is that? So if she had worked for it and earned it, would it make you any less of a greedy, ungrateful, Bama-backed bitch asking her for it? Heifer. She hit some numbers. Now, all of a sudden, she acts like the Queen of England. What pisses me off is that she has the nerve to be stingy with her money when it comes to me. Sure, she let me stay in her townhouse, but that's only because of Blue. She gives Blue more money than she does me. She'll give me a pair of shoes or a bag she no longer wants, but not any cash. However, Blue gets everything she asks for. Maybe that'll change now that Blue was caught doing the unthinkable. How you gonna be jealous of your own child? Hopefully, she was permanently stained in my mother's eyes. Despite being high, I was heated. Just the thought of her caused my head and chest to get tight. I sat in the parking lot and watched the lights flicker above my head. Moths buzzed in the air while a rat scurried across the sidewalk. I was tired of looking at the hood. It was so dusty and disgusting. I needed a vacation, but my rich mama refused to help me out with that one. She's always hated me, and I've never known why. Maybe it's because you are ungrateful hussy. Heifer. It's not like I've gotten her house torn up because I was hiding drugs or a murder weapon there. It ain't like I've asked her to put her house up for bail or gave her heartache by being sentenced for murder. Nor have I had multiple kids by multiple men and asked her for money to care for them. My biggest mistake was having Blue at 17, but that's the worst of it. Yes, she treats me worse than my brothers, who have done all of the above. I used to think it was because my father wasn't shit. Some women are mean to the children of fathers they hate, but that's not it. Most of my brother's fathers ain't shit either. All of them except Blake, her favorite child. Once the high had cemented into my body, I started my car to head to her hotel. I turned on the radio, but I was barely listening to it. I just needed the background noise to keep me awake. When I arrived at the hotel, I stopped at the bar. Weed wasn't enough to endure a conversation with that woman. "Can I get a double shot of Patron?" I asked the bartender. "Sure, just a second." He slid the drink across to me, and I downed it like a pro. When I was finally numb, I made my way to her penthouse suite on the top floor. This woman was so dramatic, wasting all of this money staying at a hotel for months. I knocked on the door, and finally she opened it. "You stink," she said, while grimacing at me. Her eyes darted up and down before she turned away in disgust. "Blue, come on," I announced. "Not so fast," Mama stopped us. "What now? I'm tired. I've been standing on my feet for hours. My body aches. I'm ready to go to bed. You should have just brought her home so that I could have avoided this drive." "Take her home so that she could be alone for hours? So she can invite boys over like your fast ass used to do? Absolutely not. See, that's why she's doing shit like that, because of you. Your whorish ways are rubbing off on her. You've been having men in and out of you since you was 13, Mama spoke through gritted teeth. I guess the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree now, does it? I smirked. I never had bad pussy management like you. Are you kidding me? Not with that clown car pussy you have. 6 kids, 6 baby daddies, strong ass uterus. As soon as the words left my lips, her hand slammed into my cheek. The sting reverberated throughout my entire body, leaving me stunned. She hadn't hit me since I was a little girl, but I guess that Patron had loosened my tongue too much. You need to take responsibility for your daughter before she ends up like you, working a dead-end job because she had a baby too young. You're too careless with her. You let her have too much time on her hands. You don't get off from work until 10. You let her run around with that girl, Sharmika. I'll be damned if she messes up and not go to college, especially now that I have the money to pay for it. Blue, let's go, I hollered for my child. My mother wanted to act self-righteous when in reality she was worse than Blue and I put together. My mom had men in and out of her life since I was a little girl. How else does one end up with 6 baby daddies? She thinks because she has new money that she can talk down to me. She was the epitome of lipstick on a pig. She may have been wealthy on the outside, but she was still the same gutter bitch on the inside. Well, she a gutter bitch with money that you want, bitch. So now what? Let me pick her up from school from now on. She needs to be supervised, Mama spoke. She was right in that regard. Blue got out of school at 3 and had all that time to herself. I knew that she did her homework because she had the grades to reflect that, but God knows what else she got into. I can't deal with this right now. I'll let you know tomorrow, I replied as I opened the door. Bye, Grandma, Blue said. Bye, Blue. Eventually, we made it to the car, but I still hadn't said a word to her. I was so pissed at my mother running her mouth as if she wasn't part of the problem. If she would have let me quit my job so that I can go to school, I could keep a better eye on Blue. No, you wouldn't, bitch. You'd be at school meeting new niggas to fuck. The hell? As soon as I started driving, I asked my daughter, what were you thinking? I wasn't. Clearly. Who was this boy anyway? What little boy made you debase yourself and drop to your knees in a school bathroom? Shit. Did he even eat your pussy first? Or are you just out here looking like Boo Boo the Fool? I don't want to talk about it anymore. She looked out the window. Her side profile was just like mine. Sometimes looking at her was like looking in a mirror. Even her behaviors were starting to resemble mine. I had to nip it in the bud. Do you want to be a teen mom? My mouth can't get pregnant, she sassed. That's not the point. Giving head leads to sex. I use condoms, she replied while peering down at her nails. Condoms break. Plan B, or you could let me take birth control like I've been asking. No, I'm not encouraging you to have sex. I'm gonna do it anyway, she shrugged. I swear, you wanna end up like me? With a baby, working a dead-end job, huh? I ain't got no man. No real men take me seriously. All they see is a slut that gave it up too quick. Is that what you want? Without responding, she extended her hand to the radio station and turned it up. No God. Baby, the way she would have been drawn back a complete fucking pretzel, because I'd have twisted her whole goddamn arm into a slipknot. I'm talking to you. You don't tell me that you don't want to talk about it no more and then turn up the radio. No, God. Child, the way she would have been missing half of the fucking shit on the side of her face, I don't even understand. They'd have been like, how did you get like a steering wheel print on the side of your face? My mama. Exactly. My words went in one ear and out the other. I didn't dare beat or spank her. Mama used to tear into me and I vowed never to hit my daughter. And since I had her at such a young age, we had more of a sister-sister relationship. That's where you fucking up at. Child, listen, you can have a good rapport, a good relationship with your child, and still lay the smack down if necessary. Think I'm bullshitting. It works. That's that nigga upstairs. I still swing a number 12 cast iron skin. Because I swear niggas think just because they taller than you and younger than you, that you won't ring they fucking bells. That's what that goddamn skillet is for. Get you one. Anyway, I was the type of mom that didn't mind if she drank, as long as she only did it in the house. I knew that kids had sex, drank, smoked. Adults be in so much denial, but if kids really want to do something, they'll find a way. That's true, but I need their asses to be so scared to do it that they consider what would happen if they come home to me after doing it. Right. That's what I'm talking about. I just wanted her to do it in the house where I knew she'd be safe. She ain't always safe in the house either. The fuck? Not if you got men in and out of there. I reached forward and turned down the radio. Blue, I want you to have a better life than I did. You're smart. You're beautiful. You can have anything you want out of life. You don't want to work in a store on your feet for your entire life like me and your grandma. She lucked up by winning that lottery. But that's super rare, all right? You have to make better decisions. And I know them boys look good or whatever, but don't have sex at school. You're lucky that it happened after school or else people would be talking. I understand, she replied to shut me up. Cool. Grandma will be picking you up from school from here on out. Come on, please. No, that's my time to chill, do my homework, and watch TV. Nope. I gotta make sure you finish high school with no babies. That generational curse ends right now. Your grandma had me at 17 and kept having babies. I stopped at you. I don't even want you to start. Man, whatever, she replied while reaching for her phone to text. When we got home, I made my way to the kitchen to pour a glass of wine to ease the stress of the day. I was dickless for now, so I figured I'd have some wine while I perused plenty of fish. You want some? I asked Blue. Yeah, just a little. See, she was somewhat responsible. She showed some restraint. What the fuck is this? How is she rationalizing this? Wow. Here you go. Did you finish your homework at the hotel? Yeah, I'm gonna go take a shower. See you in the morning, she replied flatly. I hated when she was mad at me. She was my best friend, and when she got upset, it hurt me. It was like I had no one to talk to or confide in. I had a few girlfriends, but Blue and I were close. You want to hit the rest of this? I offered the half-smoked blunt. Thanks, Mama, she smiled. It was rare I gave her weed. She could smoke from time to time, but she had to get it herself. Once I handed over the blunt, I made my way upstairs. It was midnight and I was ready to crash. I didn't have to be at work until the afternoon, so I'd be able to sleep in. When I entered my bedroom, I took a glimpse at myself in the mirror while I undressed from my Dollar Tree uniform. That gray polo shirt hugged my double D breasts, still letting men know that I was sexy despite its ugliness. I typically wore stretchy khakis to show off the rest of my curvy figure. Just because the clothes were ugly didn't mean that I had to feel ugly in them. I was about 5'5", with rich mahogany skin, a pair of full lips, and a beauty mark above them adorned my face. My slanted brown eyes looked weary, but my skin still looked supple. My body bounced back after I had blue. A lot of people mistook us for sisters once she became a teenager. Despite being overworked and stressed out, I looked younger than my age. I slipped in a pair of black sweats and a t-shirt before sprawling out on the bed. While scrolling through Plenty of Fish, I downed a glass of wine. Do black people use Plenty of Fish, y'all? That's what I need to know. Do they really use that site? I don't even understand. I thought only white people use Plenty of Fish. I don't know. Are black people on there? Damn, I wished I had bought the whole bottle upstairs. Blunt odor wafted to my nose. She was probably going to finish that tonight. I needed to hit up my weed man tomorrow because I only had a little nugget left. The men on Plenty of Fish were hideous. Fat, busted, ashy, and ugly men littered my eyes. Ugh. There was no new dick for me on there. Plenty of Fish bored me, so I scrolled Instagram and I wished I hadn't. The first post was a picture of Blue's father with his new family. Derek Lawson. I was only 16 when I started messing with him, but he was 21. Derek was a college student on the verge of graduating. He made me all of these promises, but when I became pregnant, he disappeared. When I told him I was pregnant, he told me to find the real daddy because he pulled out. I can't lie. At the time, I had a couple of boyfriends, but I knew that he was her father. Those other boys I used condoms with or only gave them head. But Derek was special. He was older, sexier, smarter, a college student on his way to law school. It took almost 5 years to finally give him a paternity test, but he wanted nothing to do with the Blue. He pays child support, but I never used a dime. I knew my baby was smart, so I put that money in an account to earn interest for her college education. Now that Mama has won the lottery, she'll be paying for Blue's education, but at some point, I'll give her the money to do with it whatever she wants. Feeling hurt, misused, and betrayed, my face started to get warm as if I were gonna cry. Seeing pictures of Derek always broke my heart and reminded me of how rejected I've been. Men have always used me up and thrown me out. That's because you do that shit to yourself. They only doing to you what you do to yourself, child. The only thing I've ever been able to get from them is sex. And at this point, that was all I wanted. All the extra shit led to nowhere. And now I was alone, single, dead-end job, hurt. I wanted something to ease my pain. The wine and weed weren't doing a good job tonight. I needed an orgasm, the kind that Dion gives. He probably was still available. Now that Blue's about to go to sleep, I could sneak out and sneak in before she even goes to school. I called Dion twice, but he didn't answer. Finally, I sent a text message. Daddy, I need you. Within 2 seconds, he called me back. You done acting childish? He asked, his deep voice moving through my body. Yes. Come over and taste this dick then, he replied. Hearing him invite me over perked me up. I jumped to my feet and took a quick hoe bath, slipped in some lingerie, and was out the door in 10 minutes. Sex always made the pain go away. And that's the end of that chapter. This bitch is insane, y'all. In case y'all didn't know. Oh my God, the only pain sex makes go away is cramps, menstrual cramps. If you got cramps, yeah, if you got cramps, child, have you a good orgasm. I promise you'll thank me later. So anyway, all right. That was the end of that chapter, child, in case y'all didn't know. Anyway. Oh, my God, today. All right, so let me Let me get the next time stamp, honey, because I wrote it down, but I let it pass. All right. Hold on, y'all. Give me 1 second. Okay. Okay. I swear this shit is going so damn fast. This don't make no sense. Some days the shit goes so slow, you literally standing there holding your dick for 3 hours waiting on the numbers to get right. And then other times it's fucked up. Whatever. Chapter 4, Blue. There she goes again. We haven't been in the house a good 30 minutes before she ran out to be with some man. I shrugged it off because I understood. When you got that itch, you gotta scratch it. It brought me back to the few moments I shared with Avon today. His pipe was actually bigger than Micah, and I thought that was big. I thought about Avon and wondered why he hadn't texted me after we got caught in the bathroom. He never even checked to see if I were okay. I sent him a quick text asking if he was still up. Rather than stare at the screen waiting for a reply, I finally called Char. I didn't want to speak to her when I was at Grandma's, since she was so far up my ass and in my business. What she said about Char pissed me off. Char did start having sex before me, but she wasn't fast. What does that even mean anyway? Old bitches stay calling us young hotties fast because we like sex, just because their pussies are slow and dry. Pause, young lady. Who the fuck you calling slow and dry? Chow bye. They start hating on us because we look better. And I love my grandma, but she was tripping, especially reneging on my G-Wagon. Every time I thought about that, I got tight in the chest. Me and Shaw was supposed to be riding to school in my new whip while dripping on those hoes. I was so ready to show off. No other student was pushing something as luxurious as a G-Wagon. Well, except for Demetria Young. She had an old-ass Lexus, so, and other kids was pushing Cobalts and Focuses. I was gonna stun on these hoes in my new car. What happened? Char asked as soon as she answered the phone. Girl, bitch, I'm in here nodding off. I've been waiting to hear your side of the story. It's been hours. What you mean, my side of the story? It's all over these group chats that you and Avon got caught doing it in the bathroom. What? Yeah, it's wild. Apparently somebody heard you screaming. I was like, damn, Avon got her screaming in school. Then an admin heard y'all. He came in and saw you busting it wide open on the sink. The excitement in her voice made my stomach twist in knots. This was unbelievable. None of that happened. None of that is true. Who's saying that? Tamir? Tamir won't tell me anything. He said it's man code to not discuss what Avon told him. But I was in a group chat, the one with Jonte, Tamika, and a few other people. And they was like, you and Avon was getting it in. So what happened? I mean, first of all, we were in the stall. Second of all, we made out and I did that to him. Then I heard Mr. Gaines tell us to come outside. Damn, that would have been crazy if you and Mr. Gaines did it. It would have been some P-Hub shit. I would let Mr. Gaines tag team me any damn day. He is fine, Char blasted. Girl, stop. This is serious. It wasn't nearly as crazy as people are making it out to be. Who in the hell would be spreading rumors like that? Why would Avon play me like that? I asked. He's a baller. You know how they are. Have you spoken to him? I checked my phone before answering her, but there was no response to my text. No, I haven't. Call him, then call me back. Okay. Quickly, I ended the call and then dialed Avon. Groggily, he answered, yo, can we talk? I gotta run early in the morning. I'll holler at you tomorrow. Wait, are you telling people we had sex in the bathroom? I don't lie on my dick. I don't have to. You see how quickly you fell to your knees? That's how quick any Henley bitch will. I don't have to lie for clout. I'll talk to you tomorrow. He hung up the phone without giving me a chance to state my piece. His callousness stunned me. I was too in shock to even call Char back. What the hell? Why would he speak to me like that? And who spread those rumors? Tears eased out of my eyes as I laid there paralyzed. Char texted me to ask if he picked up. I didn't even bother responding. I put my phone on airplane mode and forced myself to go to sleep. And there's a break in the chapter. I'm annoyed. Okay. I was trying to click this thing. Now y'all see how I jump. Hey, gentle Leo. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. This is a mess, y'all. We ain't even through with this chapter yet. All right, let me get to it. Hearing Mama close the front door woke me up before my alarm. When I looked at my phone, it was 6 a.m. I didn't have to be up for another hour, but I couldn't sleep any longer. In fact, I tossed and turned all night long. I took my phone off of airplane mode and woke up to several text messages from Char. What did he say? Are you okay? Sis, answer the phone. It's gonna be okay. You want my big brother to jump his ass? Text me when you get up. Char was such a good friend to me. I felt bad for not responding before I put her on airplane mode. As soon as I read the last text message, I responded. And she says, I got played. I think I need to skip school today. Shit's gonna hit the fan. 10 minutes later, she replied, okay, meet me at the bus stop on 52nd and Chambers at 8 a.m. Okay, we'll text you when I'm heading out. After laying in bed thinking about how I played myself for Avon, I finally mustered the strength to take a shower. I'm glad she realized that she played her damn self because, yeah. L Boogie, no, she did not. She did not hold back a thing. Mama was back in bed, finally getting some sleep after getting her back blown last night. Once I was done showering, I made my way downstairs for breakfast. This townhome is the one that Grandma used to live in before she hit it big and moved to that hotel. She got it renovated and it looks pretty decent compared to what it used to look like. It used to be a dump. Holes in the walls, the carpet was tattered and stained, the appliances were old and didn't work. But the house is nice now. It's much better than that raggedy apartment we used to live in. When I entered the kitchen to grab a banana, I saw Mama in there reading something on her phone. You're up? I asked. Yeah, I'm taking you to school. Why? I can walk. I need to know where you're at all times. You need a little break from Sharmika. Y'all won't be walking to school together for a while. I need my exercise. Work out at the hotel's gym when your grandma comes to get you. Wait, you're not letting me walk home either? Not for a while. Hurry up so I can drop you off. I sucked my teeth and mentally said, fuck it, to the banana. I sent a text to Char to tell her that we had to meet at school. However, I didn't plan on staying. I needed a break for a couple of days. And there's another break. Your grandmother will be here at 3. I'll come get you when I get off of work, Mama said as I walked out of the car. Whatever, I murmured. I hated when she tried to play strict mom. That was not her style, and I knew this little punishment wouldn't last longer than a week. I wasn't thinking about her nor her antics. I slammed the car door behind me and walked towards Henley High. The building looked like a prison. Red bricks, every few windows and steel doors accompanied the old structure that looked like it was created for imprisonment rather than learning. Unfortunately, I had to walk into the school, wait a while until my mama was gone, and then I could head out. I didn't want to show my face in that place, especially not after people learning about what happened between me and Avon. He was a dick for not texting me back. As I made my way through the halls, I heard people snickering and whispering. They were talking about me. Every cell in my body could detect the judgment in the jokes. Sup, Blue? A boy named Tavares spoke to me when I passed him. I didn't even bother responding because I knew he was on some bullshit. Oh, you can't speak? Had too much dick in your mouth. Avon bruised your throat, he laughed, causing a few others around him to crack up. Looking straight ahead, I lifted my middle finger to the air. That's exactly what I want, for you to fuck me, he laughed again. This was a nightmare that I now had to bear. I would forever be known as the girl who did that in the bathroom at school. Tears begged to fall out my eyes, but I held them. My face became hot, as did my chest. The temperature in the school was cool, but I was burning up from the inside out. I just wanted to get the hell out of there because hell was somewhere brewing inside of me. I sent Char a text to see where she was. You here yet? I'm by the track. Come to the back. I walked through the rest of the building with hundreds of eyes on me. Every pair that I passed were filled with judgment, ridicule, and disdain. Instead of being the flyest rich bitch in the school, I was now the class thot. I wished I'd never went downstairs to Avon. I wished that he'd never text me. Just as I made my way to the back doors of the school, I saw Mr. Gaines talking to another student. He thought he was so fine. I could see it in his stance, the way he held his mouth. Ugh! There was a part of me that thought he had something to do with the rumor spreading, but in my heart, I knew it was all Avon. He probably couldn't wait to tell people that I went down on him in the bathroom. Miss Jones, I heard Mr. Gaines say when I passed him. Yes? Don't forget you have detention after school. I'll be there. I rolled my eyes and kept walking, but I wasn't showing up. Detention was usually so packed and disorganized that they wouldn't even know I wasn't there. When I made my way to the track, I saw Sharmika kissing Tamir. Their tongues were intertwined out in the open, making me sick to my stomach. "What's up?" Tamir greeted when I walked up to them. "Hey, tell your boy it's on sight," I said to Tamir. "Ha, what? You gonna fight a nigga twice your size? He needs to know that he should watch his back," I threatened. "Aight, I'll let him know. Holler at you later, Mika." He kissed her on the cheek and walked towards the school. "We gotta get out of here. You got any weed?" I asked. "Yeah, my brother hooked me up. We can go back to my house. My mother will be at work all day. My brother also left us some Grey Goose, so we straight." "Good. I can't believe Avon did that to me. And then it was only for a few seconds. You would think he would act right so that he could get the rest." I shook my head. "Girl, you know he got girls jumping at the chance to be with him. Tamir was just telling me he's talking to some college girl. I'm sorry about that shit for real," she said, while draping her arm over me. "I feel so stupid. Everybody gets played at least once in their lifetime." "Nah, this is different. Getting played is one thing, but having the whole school think I'm some kind of hoe? It'll pass. Remember Erica?" she asked, referring to the girl who let five boys run a train on her at a party last summer. "Hell yeah, I was there. They all went into that room one after another." "Right. No one even talks about it anymore." "True. People may have stopped talking about it, but they didn't stop thinking about it. It was going to be forever in the back of our minds. Whenever I think of Erica, that's the first thing that comes to mind before I remember she's a talented artist in our fine arts program. Or that she knows how to braid hair really well. Or that her little brother died in a car accident our freshman year. No, the first thing that I remember when I think of her is how she had no self-respect and let all those boys have their way with her. And that's all that they'll remember about me. That I'm a thot who does that type of stuff in the bathroom. My life is officially over." And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, why do we be thinking when we're in high school that every time something bad happens, our life is just fucking over? Like, every single time. Like, oh my God, is that it? I need to switch schools. Child, no. Mm-mm. By the time the average person graduates college, honey, you can't even remember half the names of the motherfuckers you went to high school with. And fuck them if you can remember them. Hell, they was going through the same shit, just a different toilet. Fuck out of here. No. All right, let me get this next timestamp. Oh, wait. I thought I saw somebody else come in. There you go. Hey, Naomi. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And Angela, welcome. She said, "Hi, Saki. Can you read The Wrong Man by Mia Black?" Angela, if you're following me on Instagram, ask that same question in a DM, because that's where I go to pick out for my list. I promise you, I'm not going to remember this shit. I'm not going to remember it. So just send a DM, and then that way I'll find it and add it to my future reading list. All right? Shut up, Buck. You know how it be in high school. All of the girls be girling and the boys be boying. And listen, and rumors be flying because niggas keep lying. They will lie on their dicks. They swear up and down that they don't lie on their dicks. But yes, the fuck they do. It's plenty of girls walking around right now with a fucked up reputation because some dude lied and said he got some when he really didn't. Y'all know niggas be lying, child. The fuck? Mm-mm. We ain't gonna act like y'all don't be lying on y'all Petey Wee Strongs. Mm-hmm. Because y'all do. All right, so before I start this next chapter, what say you, sippers and speakers? Are we finishing this fucking book or are we moving on to something else? Because I'll end this fucking live right here, private this fucking video and delete it. And then I'll pick another book and we'll start that tomorrow and start the whole thing all over again. So y'all let me know. What are you thinking? We ain't even got to the daughter fucking on the mama's man. But at this point, I don't know. So I'm waiting on y'all to let me know what's up. Because listen, I don't give a fuck. Just like that other book we stopped reading. What was it? Low Love, Low Fidelity. I stopped reading it on the channel, but I finished reading it, and it was actually that's more of an acquired taste. That's something more for my safe space girls over there, because we talks about and know about and types of things over there. So yeah, that place is So I don't know. That's where we at. That book is for over there. Okay, so wait. Okay, so Kay said, we can see how this play out. Nikki T said, I want to hear more. Wifey is doing the face palm, child. L Boogie is peeking through her fingers. Lenora said, it's dragging, but I guessed. Kim Cass said, now you know when you said leave and come back tomorrow, we're going to say yes, we like it. Right, because y'all just want me in y'all ear. That's it. Y'all don't give a fuck. Okay, so she said, nah, but keep going. All right, so CeCe said, I don't know what to think. All right, so Cleopatra said, hey, like always, I'm late and confused, but I'm here if you are. Okay. So Bella said, I don't want to waste time like that other book. Okay, wait, so Jazzy said, more please. And his and wifey said, I guessed. Okay. Oh my God. Okay. All right. So we're gonna see. We may get further into the book and it'd be something worth writing home to your ugly ass grandma about. But then again, maybe not. But we're gonna see one way or the other. I tell you what, I've gone as far as chapter 11 with some books, and y'all know that. So we might get to chapter 11 and figure, fuck this bullshit. So let's just see. Let's just let the, Bella said, but keep reading for the people in the cut. All right, Bella. I know, right? I know, but that's what we expect. We expect it, and it's okay. It's okay. We're about to see. All right, so let me revamp the timestamp, child, since I passed it laughing at y'all. All right, and Seti said it's all right. All right, so we're going to see. Lord have mercy. Chapter 5, Donetta. A pink sports bra and legging set from Gymshark hugged my plump curves as I eyed myself in the mirror while doing squats. Man, I look good. I've come so far from what I used to look like. I wonder when will I stop gawking at my body like I've never seen it before. Dr. Rodriguez did amazing work on me. I almost want to send him another thank you card. Place your weight, I think they meant on your heels, but they put in. Focus, Donnie, my boy toy personal trainer Jordan instructed. He guided me with his hands on my hips in the deep squat. Even though I paid for this new body, I knew I had to keep it up by working it out. You keep touching me like that, and we'll be working out in bed. Oh, we're doing both, he said as he licked his lips. Jordan was gorgeous, dark skin, muscles on muscles, and had the energy of a stallion. That man had the type of dick that stayed hard even after he nutted. Then again, he is only 27. Prime age, if you ask me. I swear I started aging backwards when I started messing with him. Now I understand why old men keep a young woman on their arms to help them stay youthful. Child, it works differently for old men. These older men get the life sucked out of them and the worms by these younger women, child. Listen, oh, you know it, they ass be shriveled up and wrecked to damn die. Oh, but us older women, shall we get the kinks worked out and get the muscle tone back? Your knees be lubricated. They only pop every once in a while, you got to keep you a young one on deck. Anyway, yeah, he was young enough to be my son, but that didn't matter. As long as he came through a few nights a week to put it on me, then I was fine. We had a wonderful arrangement. I paid him generously for his personal training skills, and in return, he got my entire body in shape. You can go deeper, he said, as I bent my knees, trying to go lower. That's what I'm supposed to say to you, I flirted. You go deep now, I'll go deep later. Yes, God. Deal. The gym at the hotel was small, but it had just enough equipment to keep me slim and toned. However, the gym in my new house is going to be state-of-the-art. I couldn't wait until my home was completed. In fact, I had a meeting with my interior decorator after this training session. I watched in the mirror as I did several more rounds of planks, squats, and lunges. My body felt much more limber now that I've been working with him. He stretched me out in more ways than one. I bet, bitch, and I ain't mad at you, you heard me? At the end of the session, he had me lay down, extend one leg out in front of me, and one towards the sky. Jordan then anchored himself between my thighs and began to help me stretch. I got wet just at the suggestive position. If I didn't have this meeting in an hour, I would most certainly lure him up to my suite and put it on him. You're much more flexible than when we first started. I wish I had taken pictures, he said, as he switched my legs. Me too. Before, I couldn't touch my toes, but thanks to you, I can bend in all kinds of ways, I laughed. You got time for a bed workout? He asked as he pushed my leg further back while stroking my pussy. Even though it didn't direct contact, or I think she meant wasn't direct contact, it was enough to send me into a frenzy. I wish. How about you come through later? All right, I'll let you know. And then there's a break in the chapter. No, y'all didn't say they give you worms. Oh, Lord. Oh, my God. Yes, honey. Yes. Oh, my God. Y'all a mess. After my session with Jordan, I rushed back to my suite and took a much-needed shower. Warm water cascaded over my body as I thought about all the things I had to do today. After the meeting with my interior decorator, I had to go visit my mother at the nursing home with my sisters. Then I had to pick up my grandbaby from school. When I stepped out of the shower, I draped my white Versace robe over my body. When I hit the lottery, I upgraded every area of my life. Even my terry cloth was luxurious. Okay, girl. I smoothed sweet almond oil all over my skin and added rosehip seed oil to my surgery scars. They were disappearing easily with my oil mixture. Finally, it was time to get dressed. I pulled out my Fendi monogram blouse and a pair of black skinny jeans. My Fendi loafers were going to be perfect to complete the look. I bought my grandbaby a pair of those loafers, too. Felt so good to walk into a store and drop $1,400 on two pairs of shoes. Child, just because you can don't mean you should, because listen, hell no. Pause for a second. Cece, she said, working out with your partner is so sexy. It's great foreplay. Yes, it is. If you're in the weight room. But listen, when your nigga wants you to go running on a 10-mile run with his young ass, no God, ain't shit sexy or foreplay-like about that shit. I probably made it down the fucking block and was like, I'll catch you on the next round. No God, the nigga run too fast. You got me fucked up. No God. Mm-mm. No. No, hell no. Shit. I feel young, goddammit, but that don't mean I can run no damn 10 miles. Walk, maybe, but we're going to have to walk slow. But this nigga want to run like he got a fucking rabbit in front of him or a stick he got to catch. Get the fuck out of here. Once I was dressed, I began to beat my face. MAC foundation and concealer, naked highlighter, and Kat Von D red lipstick. I looked like $1 million. My hair was still pulled up in a top knot, but I decided that sometime this week I needed to set a hair appointment. Girl, you doing too much. Now that I was fully dressed, I grabbed my large Fendi shades and purse, then headed out of the hotel. It felt good to look this good. To know that my opulence turned heads made me feel like I've never felt before. Gone were the days where I was dismissed for my age and haggard appearance. Now I was acknowledged by everyone no matter where I went. 20 minutes later, I was walking into my interior decorator's office. Celeste Anderson was the most sought-out interior decorator in the DMV. Her style was impeccable, and she was very expensive, but I only wanted the best for my new home. After living with the worst for so long, there was no going cheap on the things I wanted. Good morning, Ms. Jones, she greeted when I stepped into the office. Good morning. I'm so glad we're almost done. Yes, I can't wait to see everything in the house. So, today we're discussing bathrooms. And I want chrome and real marble. I want a dry sauna as well as a steam room, a clawfoot bathtub with jets, a rain shower head. I rattled off the list of my demands for my bathrooms. I wanted to live in a spa. I needed it to look like a trip to a Japanese bathhouse, serene and healing. When people come over, I want jealousy to be oozing out of them like pus. I wanted them to wish their home was like mine. For once in my life, I wanted the people around me to envy me rather than me envy them. Girl, that shit ain't all it's cracked up to be either. Because then you really got to watch your back. For years, I was jealous of my sisters. They all had hardworking husbands to take care of them and their children. They lived in nice homes and drove nice cars. Every family get-together, they would pull out pictures of their vacations to exotic locations. They'd show pictures of their children grown up and doing well. I hated hearing them talk about how their lives were so perfect. Meanwhile, I was struggling with my kids, and most of them are failures. But who's the failure now? Not me. I'm officially rich. I'm the wealthiest of the bunch. Yes, me. The high school dropout and teen mom. Yes, me. The mother of six children. They all underestimated me, but now I was the one who was doing the best out of all of them. They were all aging like spoiled milk, while I was looking like MILF of the century. Okay, I'll let all of these ordered for you. She said let, but it's supposed to be get, child. What do you think about this? Celeste interrupted. My thoughts to show me virtual mock-ups of my new bathrooms. They look perfect. I can't wait to soak in that tub. Oh, trust me, you're gonna love it. I have one just like it. It's my mini getaway within my home. I can't wait, I exclaimed, smiling from ear to ear. When our meeting was finished, I made my way to meet my sisters at the nursing home where my mother was staying. The closer I got to the nursing home, the more my joy began to slip away. My mother knew how to suck the life out of me, even though she was basically crippled and unable to take care of herself. I'm the oldest girl, and I truly think from birth she's hated me. She's never been nice to me. As far back as I can remember, she's treated me differently than she treated my sisters. But the funny thing, I was Daddy's favorite of all the girls. However, Mama blames me for Daddy's early death. He died when I was just 11 years old. My other siblings were much younger, and the worst part is, I was there when it happened. I'll never forget that man who tried to rob Daddy and shot him in the chest. Watching his body hit the ground replayed in my mind over and over. I could still smell the vanilla and feel the burning sunshine from that day. The memory was seared into my mind. One second, y'all. Give me one second. Sorry, y'all. Okay. Okay. Mama said it was my fault because Daddy was taking me to get ice cream and that if he were home, he'd still be alive. Once Daddy died, all hell broke loose in my house. Before, my father's presence was enough to keep my mother from mistreating me. But when he died, that went out the window. That bitch treated me like Cinderella, and I wasn't a stepchild. I was forced to clean the entire house while my sisters didn't have to do anything. She would give them money for new clothes, but wouldn't give me shit. I had to wear hand-me-downs and thrifted items while they got nice outfits from department stores. When I arrived in my shiny Tesla outside of the nursing home, I took a deep breath in. There was no amount of mental preparation that I could do to get me through this. I always left feeling anxious and in need of a drink. To make sure I was presentable, I pulled down my visor to check my lipstick. From my peripheral, I saw one of my younger sisters, Angela, pull up in her C-class. Angela was an attorney at a corporate law firm downtown. Out of the six of us, she was probably Mama's favorite. She looked the most like her, and she was successful. Actually, all my sisters were successful. Three were nurses. One was a real estate agent, and then Angela, the lawyer. I was the only one that didn't have a professional career, and it turns out that I never needed it. All I needed was my daddy to visit me in a dream and give me the winning lottery numbers. "Morn, Donnie," Angela greeted me when we got out of the car. She was wearing some off-the-rack wrap dress, probably from Marshall's or TJ Maxx. She was always talking about financial planning and saving money. Despite having a high salary, she never bought designer clothes at full price. "Morn, Angela," I replied. I was the oldest, 51 years old. Angela was 49. Maya and Zora, the twins, were 47. Alice was 45 and Tony, 43. They were all very young when Daddy died, so they don't remember him as much as I do. I was the one most hurt by his death. To this day, I have nightmares of that moment when he was shot before my eyes. That was my best friend and the only one in my family that cared for me. I see you still wasting your winnings on depreciating goods. Is that jealousy I hear? No, darling. Why would I be jealous of a woman who's going to be right back in poverty in a few short years? Enjoy it while it lasts, she replied flippantly. I wanted to punch her in the face, but I remained cool. I was not going to be broke in a few years. Sure, I was having fun now, but I had already invested half the money. I was on the verge of buying a rental property, too, but I didn't bother explaining to her jealous ass. She's just mad because she's, I think she meant relegated, but she put regulated. No, it's relegated to buying abnormal and out-of-season clothes from discount department stores. Whatever makes you feel better at night when you're putting clothes in layaway, I laughed. Damn. As we walked into the nursing home, I heard a few voices around the corner. I recognized them as the voices of my other sisters. Angela and I had the worst relationship, but me and the others were cordial. I wouldn't consider them friends. They were always looking down their noses at me because of how some of my kids turned out, like I'm the one that told them to go out to sell drugs and murder people. Hey, Ange and Donnie. Tony, the baby, walked over to hug us. She was the most bubbly and cheerful out of all of us. Hi, I hugged her back. They've taken Mama to physical therapy, but we should all go into her room so that we can discuss some important matters, Tony spoke. I bet you they want her to pay for some shit, and if I was her, I'd tell them, flag on the motherfucking play. I'm not paying for shit, because if I hadn't won, you raggedy bitches would have come up with the money to do whatever, so do that shit now. Pretend like I didn't win, even though I did. I'm not giving you shit, just like that bitch gave me. No God. I followed them down the hall into Mama's room. I really didn't want to be there, but I figured I had no choice. Even though she was terrible to me growing up, she was still my mother. Girl, that's some bullshit. Once we were in the tight room, Zora closed the door behind her. Mama's getting worse, Tony started. Yeah, the last time I was here, she was having trouble swallowing her food, Angela added. Our mother has Parkinson's, and it's been taking a toll on her body. She couldn't keep her hands stable, and it was becoming difficult to chew and swallow. What are the doctors saying? I asked. You would know if you stopped playing with all of your new toys and came around more, Angela blasted. Angie, stop. She's here now, Maya interrupted. I ain't thinking about Angie's hating ass. I waved her off dismissively. Listen, it's time for you to do your part. We've been footing the bills for years, Angie said. What are you talking about? Daddy's money from his investments that he left her have been caring for her, not to mention her pension and retirement fund. Y'all don't pay for that much. Hold on, y'all. Something just popped up on my computer. That's not true, Donnie. We're here more than you, and we've spent a lot of money, Alice stated. Okay. I looked at them confused. They wanted money, but they needed to come out and ask me. I wanted to hear them grovel. There's this new experimental treatment in Zurich. It has an 89% success rate in putting Parkinson's into remission permanently. Mama's still cognitively functional, but if her Parkinson's was gone, she could go back to living a normal life. She's only 75, and she could live a nice life if she weren't this sick, Tony spoke. Zurich? All the way in Europe? Yes, Tony replied. How much is it? That's the thing. It's very expensive. It's $1 million for the first year, and then $250,000 every year after that. Huh? I asked, raising my eyebrow. It was pure comedy to me. I walked backwards and plopped into the reclining chair in the room. We know it's a lot of money, but we were hoping that you would use your winnings in a way to benefit the family. You'll still have plenty left to do the things you want to do. This is just a small sacrifice to help our mother. Alice begged. That could cause me to go broke. Are you serious right now? No, I'm not spending that kind of money on an experimental treatment. And what will y'all be contributing? That's millions of dollars out of my pocket. I don't think so. We don't have it to spend, but if we did, then we would. We're willing to come up with her first-class airfare and accommodations once we get there. Once we get there? That's me talking. Fuck they mean. No God, child. No, absolutely not. Why not? You haven't done anything for Mama but cause her grief. The words flew out of Maya's mouth. What has Mama done for me? Not a damn thing. She's berated me and hated me my whole life. Well, do it for us. We've been there for you. We've given you money to keep you from getting evicted. When Rayshawn was arrested for murder, Angela got you a good attorney, even though she knew he was guilty, Zora replied. A waste of money and favor, Angela chimed in. It didn't cost you millions to do that, so no, I will not be giving you millions of my money to help a woman who hated me. If it were a one-time fee of $250, sure, but you're trying to get me to break the bank. I'm not doing it. I'm out. Good luck. Selfish bitch, Angela muttered as I walked towards the door. What? I blasted. I could feel a wave of anger coming over me. Heat spread from the top of my head down to my toes. I was too damn fly to be fighting, but I was on the verge of whooping Angela's ass. She'd been trying me ever since we got out of our cars. I told them not to bother asking you. You're a selfish bitch, and you've always been. You're a whore who couldn't keep her legs shut and couldn't keep a job. That's why all your kids are messed up now, because you only think of yourself. Had you been there for them boys instead of running the streets, they wouldn't be in prison, Angela rambled. A laugh erupted from my lips. I may be a selfish bitch, but at least I'm a rich bitch. Toodles, hating asses. Good luck with your mama, I laughed as I made my way out of the nursing home. Those bitches always wanted to throw my past in my face. Well, the joke's on them, because I buried my past and have been reborn. My kids aren't perfect, but who is? Why did Angela think insulting me would make me want to give them money? I wouldn't give them a dime at this point. They'll just have to watch me from afar, living my best life. As I made my way down the hall, I saw a nurse wheeling my mother out of physical therapy back to her room. Her body looked so failed and shriveled that it made me crack a smile on my face. It was karma for all of the hurtful things she's done to me. Bloop. That's me talking. Shit. Mm-mm. That's exactly what the fuck it is. Completely ignoring the old hag, I slipped my Fendi shades over my face, tilted my chin to the sky, and pranced my fine ass out of there. And I made sure that she saw me, too. I hope she goes back to her room seething while thinking about how healthy and sexy I look. Meanwhile, she's drying up like the crypt keeper. When I left the nursing home, I stopped at a bistro for lunch, then went shopping for a new outfit to kill time before I was supposed to get blue. Spending money always made me feel better after an encounter with my family. Those heifers were so jealous that they couldn't even hide it, and I was going to continue to give them shit to be jealous about. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Well now, kinfolks and their expectations. Fuck you and feed you dried grapes. Yeah, raisins. Be mad. Fuck out of here. No God. Mm-mm. You don't owe them shit. Nothing. No God. You pay back a motherfucker what you owe them and that's it. If they gave you shit, then that's what you give them. Shit. Yep, and if they continue to give you shit, then you get ass led. Because that's what the fuck they deserve. Oh my God, listen today. So wait a minute, Cece said, she treated me badly my whole life, and I'm supposed to pay a million to help her? Yeah, no. Find someone else to do it. Y'all better go pop some coochie and get the money up. Right, exactly. But child, that be their expectations. And you right. Folks know they get greedy when they see you with a few coins. Exactly, Marva. Mama will be all right. Right. If she ain't, she gonna be. Mighty goddamn right. Now I just saw the skeleton pop out the car. Child, listen. I promise you. Mm-mm. No God. Don't say nothing if you don't want me to react. Don't ask me for a motherfucking thing. No, God, not for a bitch that did me dirty. Got me fucked up. Mm-mm. No. Hell no. And fuck no. Mm-mm. All right, I got the timestamp, child. I guess I'll keep going. These chapters are pretty long, you know, at least 10 minutes each, but, and it's 34 of them. Mm-hmm. And an epilogue. But we're going to see what it's hitting for. Chapter 6, Simone. Time dragged like a snail on a sidewalk in the middle of summer. This workday felt like an entire week. I swear every time I looked at the clock, it read the same hour and the same minute. Since one of our clerks called out, I had to work the front register until a part-time employee comes in this evening. Then I was going to be tasked with the inventory count, something I dreaded. I tried my best to keep my composure while I rang up customers, but I just wanted to go to my car and smoke. Exhaustion weighed on my shoulders and left my head feeling cloudy. It was difficult to think straight. The situation with my daughter was starting to bother me as well. Maybe Mama was right. Perhaps my bad habits were starting to rub off on her, but I was grown. What was I supposed to do? Not have a sex life? I had needs and desires. I was young and gorgeous. Why would I slow down? My daughter needed to have more self-control over her desires. She should have just waited until after school rather than trying to fuck in the bathroom. Hey, Simone, I heard a voice from the entrance. When I looked up, I was relieved to see that it was the district manager, Arnold. He was about Mama's age and had a huge beer belly that reached over the buckle over his pants like it wanted to nosedive to the floor. Damn, he got a whole pregnancy in his pants then. Good afternoon, Arnold, I greeted. He was probably here to help me with the inventory count. Thank God. I'd hate to have to do that shit alone. It's so tedious and draining. The only way to get through it was to be high, and I didn't want to smell like blunt smoke. I wished I had some edibles on me, though. One by one, I scanned the customer's items. My body was there, but my mind was someplace else. It was still back in Dion's bed. Rather than focus on my job, I let my brain wander to the memories of last night when he touched and licked me all over. All I could focus on was when he made me feel good. I hated that he was the only thing I had to look forward to sometimes. My life was truly tragic. Him being married made it even worse. It pained me to see all of her pictures on the walls of their beautiful shared home. The designer clothes in the closet drove me to envy. Her jewelry collection on the vanity put my swap meet jewelry to shame. Dion took good care of her and gave her whatever she wanted. He owned a few nightclubs up and down the East Coast, so he was loaded. Apparently, she didn't have to work. And when he wants to play with his side chicks, he offers her a trip out of town to go wherever with her friends. He told me this time she went to Vegas. Well, why are you giving him free pussy? Does he give you money? Because if he don't, what is the point of you fucking this nigga? And thinking about all the shit he giving his wife? Shit, you could have been working an extra shift instead of riding his dick or busting it open in a strip club or something. Jealousy welled within me like hot lava ready to shoot out. I wanted that life. I wanted a man who would take care of me, save me from my misery of working at the Dollar Tree and living in my mama's old house. Let me correct myself. I don't want a husband like Dion. That man is a dog. I'm not the only chick he's smashing. I know he's seeing other women. Lord knows what he gets into when he goes to other cities to check on his clubs. I'd rather a man just be faithful to me, but I knew that would never happen. Something was wrong with me. No man has ever loved me. They all wanted one thing, and after a while, I became okay with it. Getting touched was better than not getting anything at all, so I settled with men who don't want much of me but my pussy. Mama has said time and time again that nobody would want me because I had a baby at 17. She told me that I would be just like her with a bunch of baby daddies. No husband, just a gaggle of fatherless children. On one front, I proved her wrong. I only had one child. After having Blue, I got an IUD. I was determined to not have a bunch of kids like Mama. Those boys of hers were hellions, except for Blake and Keith, but they had decent fathers. Blake's father had custody of him, and Keith's father had joint custody. My other brother's fathers abandoned them, just like my father did me. I've met that man twice, and one of those times I was too young to remember. Mama didn't know how to pick good men. And because of that, I vowed to not be in that same position. I would never have another child again. I meant that. Blue was more than enough. I loved my daughter with all of my heart, and I tried to treat her better than Mama treated me. Mama was much more strict on me than my brothers, which made me want to rebel even more. She's always been nasty towards me, which led me to looking for love in boys. The love I couldn't find at home with her, nor with my father, led me to Blue's dad. It saddened me that Blue didn't have a father because she deserved that. I wished I'd chosen better for her. I know what it's like to be rejected and abandoned. I never wanted that for her. Maybe that's why I was lenient about what I let her do. She had more freedom as a way for me to compensate. And now that Mama's won the lottery, she was spoiled. I like that my daughter was spoiled, though. I just wish Mama had spoiled me, too. When she hit big, all she did was give me her old raggedy house. Sure, she renovated it, but she didn't give me anything else. Meanwhile, Blue got designer bags, shoes, new hairstyles, and promised a G-Wagon. I received nothing. I begged Mama to retire me from this job. Just help me out for a year or two while I got to college to build a career. And this woman laughed in my face. Retire you? Hell no. I had to work hard, so you work hard. Figure this out on your own. If you weren't being a fast-ass little girl, then you could have already gone to college, she replied to me when I asked her to help me out. I had never been so angry at her before that moment. It made me hate her. I was always afraid to allow myself to hate her. Something about hating your mother just doesn't feel right down in my soul. I felt that God would strike me down just for admitting that I hated her. But in that moment, I couldn't feel anything else but hatred, and God didn't strike me down, so I continue on hating her. Sometimes I daydreamed about killing her so that I could get her money. Then I'd have to split it amongst my brothers, which wouldn't be too bad. It would still be more money than I've ever had. Time continued to tick by slowly as I daydreamed about killing Mama. My mind bounced from strangling her, drowning her, to shooting her. Ultimately, I would have to pay someone to do it. Miss, I heard someone shout, tearing me out of my thoughts. It was a customer standing before me with her hand on her hip and a heap of items on the conveyor belt. I had no idea how long she'd been standing there since I'd been so entrenched in my ruminations. I'm so sorry, I stumbled, while quickly ringing her items up. You need to be giving me a discount since I've been standing up here waiting for you to come back from La La Land. I'm really sorry about that, I replied, while averting my eyes away from her. You sure are sorry, and then you people want us to raise the minimum wage to $30 an hour, and you can't even ring up a few things. Makes no sense, she rambled. I bit down on my bottom lip so that I didn't say anything slick. This was the third time this week a customer had berated me for something small. The other two times I exchanged words with them, which led to them threatening to call corporate. People say they'll file a formal complaint, but by the time they've gotten home, they usually forget. However, I had to keep my cool today because corporate was in the store. I bet you that's why he there, because, child, listen. Your ass about to get fired, child. Arnold was one of my bosses, and if he had heard me going tit for tat with a customer, I could get written up or worse, fired, and I couldn't afford to lose this job. Have a nice day, I said as she snatched her bags. Mm-hmm, she responded while rolling her eyes. I hated this store. I hated my job. I hated my mama for not helping me out. I hated life. I just wanted to go home, smoke, and go to sleep. Finally, other part-time workers came in. With them being here, I could get off the register and take my break. I'll be back in 30 minutes, Tiffany, I announced as I quickly left the store. I didn't even hear her say goodbye. As soon as I stepped outside, I noticed three women walking towards the Dollar Tree. One of them looked strangely familiar. As I looked closer, I began to realize who I was seeing. It was Dion's wife, Nicole, charging towards me. Nicole was a petite woman wearing a black athleisure set with a pair of Gucci sneakers on her feet. He really did make sure that she looked fresh at all times. Why couldn't I find someone like that for me? I began to turn around to avoid walking towards her, but that was futile. Bitch, you know who I am. Don't run away, she barked, with her two friends on her heels. I guess, y'all, we should just say, uh-oh, like Chris Rock, because it's about to be some shit. I'm sorry, I said. When I turned around, we were standing face to face. I was taller than her, so I was able to look down and see her ample cleavage where a gold Jesus piece rested. You ain't sorry for fucking my man. I know you was in my house last night. What? No, I wasn't. I caught you on tape, lying bitch. I can't believe Dion out here cheating on me with some hoe who work at the Dollar Tree. How did she even find me? Did he tell her where I worked? Why would he do that? Listen. No, you listen. If you ever come to my house again, I'm gonna make sure they never recover your body, bitch. You understand me? I am not to be fucked with. Dion may have all these little businesses, but I'm the daughter of a real boss
who ain't afraid to disappear somebody for me, she threatened. She don't even hold a candle to you. What the hell is he slumming for? One of her friends said as they turned to walk away. That was it. I was tired of people talking to me any kind of way. I was tired of being insulted for my job. I was tired of people looking down on me like I was a gutter rat. Today was the day that changed. I threw my self-control out the window and ran up on her. I yanked her by the ponytail, snapping her head back. I then threw her on the ground. It wasn't a fair fight, though. I hadn't thought this all the way through because before I knew it, all three of them were whooping my ass. Before the cops could come, they ran into their car and sped away, leaving me on the ground bruised and in pain. Simone, Arnold shouted as he came outside. He swiftly helped me off the ground, then brought me into the store in the office, out of sight from the customers. Are you okay? He asked as he grabbed a cold bottle of water out of the fridge. No. Do you want to go to the hospital? No, I need to go home. That's fine. I'll handle the inventory without you. Go home and get some rest. Thank you, I replied as tears fell down my cheek. Before I went home to smoke, I stopped at the liquor store for some Grey Goose. I needed all the numbing agents I could get to make this day go away. Damn, the way you look, I wish I could give it to you for free, the store clerk said when he saw my bruised face. I didn't even respond. I just took the bottle and went home to drink my pain away. This can't be life. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't even know what the hell is going on. I don't know why she thought to grab that woman and fucking, I don't know. I don't understand why she thought to fucking snatch that woman like that. And she got two friends with her. Like, are you slow or are you dumb? Because girl, that's not smart. No, God, that's why you got beat the fuck up. Welcome, Courtney Williams. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. She said, I love your reading voice. Well, thank you for that wonderful compliment. I appreciate you. Welcome, Destiny Bellamy. Oh, let's see. She said, hey, I'm catching up. I love y'all down. Well, we love you down too, boo. And welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. I don't even know what to think, child. This chapter was a lot. That was a lot because I don't know. I don't think that girl thought that whole thing through. I get it. You're fed up. You're tired. You're pissed off. You're mad. But ma'am, unless you Bruce Lee or Steven Seagal or what's that other fucking dude? Ip Man or some goddamn baddie. I don't think you should be running up on three bitches. Now, one-on-one, yeah, that's different. But that bitch had a little mini crew with her. I don't think you should have ran up on her. Some motherfuckers, you just gotta, you know, just let it go. But now that she did that shit, you can call a popo and give them her address since you know where she live. Get a cute little bag up out of her husband. You know what I'm saying? But you did start the fight, though. But I don't know. Hey, sweet coconut. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, here we go. Let's get this next fucking chapter on the road, child, because I'll be up here talking shit and we won't be through the book and then y'all'll be mad. All right, here we go. Chapter 7, Blue. My R&B playlist filled the room with tunes to express how I was feeling. Summer Walker, her, and Kehlani were on repeat while I sat on the floor, leaned against Sharmika's bed. She had a few pre-rolled joints laid out before us, like a marijuana buffet. When we got back to her spot, she changed out of her uniform into a pair of short pink gym shorts and a white t-shirt. Do you think you'll ever get your tongue pierced? She asked, as she stuck her tongue out to examine the piercing in the mirror. After what I'm going through right now? Hell no, I laughed. Like me, Sharmika was born to a teen mom. Her mother, we called Big Mika. Her real name was Tay Mika. Big Mika had Sharmika's older brother, Chauncey, at 14, and then had her at 17. Her mother was even cooler than my mom when it came to giving them freedom. Char and Big Mika got their tongues pierced together for Sharmika's 16th birthday. What? I don't even know what the fuck. How do you get your tongue pierced with your mom? Make that make sense. And her mother was down the hall right now with her new boo not giving a fuck that we were skipping school and smoking weed. I forgot why she doesn't work, but apparently she doesn't have to. She gets a check from the government, but she has a few other ways of making money. Big Mika is one of the best hair braiders in our area. She can easily make $500 for an intricate style. After I'm tired of this wig, I want some ankle-length box braids done by her. True, maybe when you get to college, when we're away from these stupid people, you can get your tongue pierced. Then we'll be twins, she laughed. I don't know. It looks like it hurts. The pain goes away. You know what I want? My nipples pierced. I was looking on IG and I saw that Lori Harvey has hers pierced. She has the little barbell kind. That's what I want. Would you do that with me? Yeah, we can do that when we turn 18, I replied. That would be sexy. It would be like having a little secret that no one knew about unless they were lucky enough to see you naked. No, they can see it through your shirt, dumbass. Oh, right. Pick a joint, she said, pointing to the one she had lined up. What are they? Sativa? Indica? Just pick one. Be surprised, she laughed. Girl, the way I'm feeling, I need something strong. They're all strong, she said. Fine, this one. I reached forward for a joint that was in the middle. Good choice. They're all good choices, though. She picked another, and we lit them up. I watched her as she opened the window so that the smoke could escape, but that wouldn't stop the room from reeking. We were both lucky to have young moms who let us do whatever we wanted. Just as our highs permeated our bodies and minds, her mom opened the door. Hey, Big Mika, I cheesed from ear to ear. I jumped up to give her a big hug. Hey, baby girl, Char told me what happened with that big-headed boy. Fuck him. He ain't even that cute, she said, trying to make me feel better. We both knew it was a lie, though. Avon was fine, and it hurt me to admit that. Yeah, I'm trying to clear my mind now. Do that. Take as much time as you need. How's your mama? I ain't seen her around in a while. Is she busy working? I replied. She need to talk to me. That work shit is for ugly bitches. She too cute to be slaving at a dollar store, but I got some peach Ciroc, Patron, and Henny downstairs if y'all want. I'm about to go to a client's home. I gotta do her weave. Thank you, Mika, I said. Thanks, Ma. We'll see you later, Sharmika replied. Damn, she just leaving him with the liquor and the weed. Okay. Within a matter of moments, her mother disappeared down the hall. We continued smoking as we relaxed on our day of skipping school. I'm about to go make us some drinks. What do you want? Char asked as she lifted her body off the bed. Girl, I'm too hungry to drink. I don't want to get sick. Let's order some takeout. What you want? Chinese? Pizza? Chinese. You order and I'll make the drink, she said. I want peach Ciroc. What soda do you have? Sprite, ginger ale, orange mango juice. Mix it with Sprite and the orange mango juice. Damn, that does sound good. I'm gonna have one too. While she was downstairs mixing our drinks, I ordered the food. I then got up and stretched out on her bed, thinking about everything that transpired. I can't believe that I got played so badly. I was the laughing stock of school. I knew that it wouldn't last long, but it still felt like it would be forever. No boys would ever take me seriously at that school, which was okay. This was my senior year anyway. Avon was the only one that I had a crush on. I was hoping that he would be my prom date, but I was going to get revenge by getting me a college boy to take me. I wasn't going to back down and hide my face. I was going to do what I did best, stunt. Hey, Sharmika's brother Chauncey barked when he burst into her room. Oh my God, boy, you scared the shit out of me. I jumped up from the bed holding my chest. You must have been in here doing something you had no business doing, he laughed. Chauncey was my big brother as well. Since we all grew up together, he had been in my corner and protective of me, just like he'd been of Sharmika. I've always considered myself lucky to have him as my brother, but now that he was 20 and had his own place, I didn't see him that often. Chauncey was a savage in these streets. He had his own operation of chop shops. Lord knows what else he was into. He once said to protect his family in case the feds ever came, he wouldn't give us any details about his business endeavors. No, I'm just in here thinking, what are you doing here? Came through to check on you. Char told me y'all was skipping today. She told me about that nigga Avon. You ain't deserve that, shorty. Thanks, but it's okay. I'll get through this. Yeah, you will, but you ain't got to get through it alone. That nigga don't have to have the last laugh, the last say-so. We can make him pay for what he did. What do you mean? I just want to forget about it. I want to forget about him, I sighed. I was getting slightly annoyed because I didn't feel like talking about Avon. I just wanted to enjoy my high without thoughts of him swirling in my mind. Let me handle him. Handle him how? What's that? Oh, gum. Thank you. Yes. Is that double mint? Hold on, y'all. Oh, thank you. Okay. Sorry, y'all. Listen, the little things please me. Like when they remember that I like gum. All right. And he got the right kind, too, because normally they just get whatever's minty. But he got the right kind. You ain't got to know how. Just say Chauncey. I want you to handle Avon. He grinned, showing his crest white smile. Chauncey shared the same light complexion and hazel eyes with his sister. Determined not to be labeled a pretty boy, he had a gallery of tattoos on his body. My favorite one was the lotus flower on the side of his neck. I love that it was a feminine tattoo, but the strength of his neck made it masculine. Handle Avon, I murmured, trying to imagine what that would be. I don't want you to kill him, I protested. Nah, I won't do that. He gonna wish he was dead, though. That's for fucking with you. He needs to know. All them little niggas at Henley need to know. What you in here doing to my guest? Shar asked when she reappeared with two cups. First of all, Blue ain't no guest. Second of all, you can't afford to skip school, nigga. I seen your last report card. Chauncey called her out. A snicker rushed from my lips before I could contain it. Fuck the both of you, she laughed at us. It was true. Sharmika's grades weren't nearly as good as mine. School didn't come as easily for her as it did me. I've always made good grades without putting much effort in. All you had to do was show up most days, listen, and do the work. I never understood why people made it harder than that. As I was saying, I can handle him. Y'all talking about Avon? Char asked as she handed me my cup. Yeah, that fuck nigga, Chauncey replied. He deserves it, Blue, she said to me before sipping her drink. Fine, do what you can, but don't kill him. I want him to suffer like I've had to suffer. My senior year could be ruined by what he did, I said, taking the cup to my face. I got you. Oh, and this is for you, Char. Take it easy with that shit, he said, while handing her a plastic baggie with a few white pills inside. What's that? I asked. Oxy, she replied. You never tried it? Chauncey asked. I haven't. What does it do? Gives you a better high than weed could ever. You want to try? Char offered. If you do try it, I would put that liquor down. You don't want to combine the two, he instructed. You take it by mouth or snort it? I asked as I sat the cup on her dresser. I prefer to take it by mouth. Takes a while to kick in, but I ain't about that putting shit up my nose life. Plus, you up your risk of overdosing that way. That shit don't make sense to me, but I was trying to understand what she was saying, but now I get it. I hate life right now, but I don't want to overdose, I laughed. Yeah, y'all be careful with that. No more alcohol while you're on it. I gotta head back to work, but I'm gonna take care of that Avon shit for you. I appreciate it, Chauncey, I called out as he turned to walk away. I got your back forever, little sis. I'll let y'all later, he said when he left. I hope this girl don't do the shit. Sharmika crushed a pill while she talked to me. He just got a flex to show people how much control he has. He's so pressed to whoop Avon's ass. As soon as I told him what happened, he been ready, Sharmika said, as she chased her pill down with alcohol. The exact opposite of what Chauncey told us to do. I decided to heed his advice. Rather than chase my pill with liquor, I chased it with water. I followed her lead of crushing it, then threw it down my throat. Water washed the dry chemical taste out of my mouth as I laid back and waited for it to kick in. By the time the food arrived, I had the most euphoric buzz rushing my system. When I walked down the stairs to get our food, I felt as if my feet never touched the ground. I was a skywalker floating through space and time. Damn, I could see why people got hooked on this. This was the best feeling I've ever experienced. When I came back upstairs, Shaw was on a FaceTime call with her boyfriend, Tamir. Something about him rubbed me the wrong way. It was probably paranoia, but he was best friends with Avon. Oh, God. They probably spread those rumors about me together. I hated Avon and Tamir, but I love this new high I was experiencing. There was no strain of weed that could beat this feeling moving through my body. Pure ecstasy, like heaven had been born inside of me. I didn't need to die to experience the sweet bliss of heaven. No, it was coursing through my veins at that precise moment. While she was on the phone talking to Tamir, I dug into my Chinese food, but without even noticing, I drifted off into a nap where nothing mattered. Not Grandma reneging on my G-Wagon, not the embarrassment, and certainly not Avon. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, did she fucking forget that she's supposed to be back at school so her Grandma Donetta can pick her up? Because what the hell? Okay, so wifey said, that's how these folks doing now. Why these babies in junior high school with these lamb chop eyelashes. Girl, I saw that where some girl, I think she was 12 or 13, had a whole fucking eagle's wing on her fucking eye. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me right now? You look like Batman summoned your ass from the depths of hell and you fly around with your fucking eyelashes. Get your bunny rabbit face ass out of here. I hate that fucking shit. I hate that. I don't know. And why would you put that on a kid? She don't even need to be worrying about what the fuck she looked like as a kid. She need to be worrying about what the fuck is in them books so she could get good grades and go out here and live the life she want to live. Hell, and she want to put them fucking bat wings on her eyelids once she grown, okay. But as a kid, y'all doing too fucking much. Let a fucking kid be a goddamn kid for a fucking second. Damn. They already face more than they could ever understand. And you putting shit on their minds that they don't look right without that bullshit when they actually do look fine. Hell, I made it all the way through my childhood with the eyelashes I was born with. Nobody said, here, put these fake ones on. And you bitches is paying to put that shit on your kids. Just going out the world butt asshole backwards. Don't make no damn sense. The fuck? I don't get it. Mm-mm. But you ain't asked me what the fuck I thought, but I'm gonna tell you any goddamn way. Fuck. Because that don't make no damn sense. I just feel like it's fucking stupid to do. But anyway. Chapter 8, child. Donetta. Thank you, miss. Have a wonderful day. The hostess at Le Chat Noir? Child, I don't even know what the fuck a Le Chat Noir is. Anybody in the DMV know what that is? That must be some new restaurant that was erected since I left there, because I don't know what the fuck that is. Said to me when I walked out of the bistro, with my Fendi shade shielding my eyes from the intrusive sun, I marched towards my bright red Tesla. My entire lunch was disturbed by thoughts of my mother and sisters. I was astounded by the audacity they had to ask me for that much money. If it were me that needed it, they wouldn't even try to help me out. To hell with my mother, to hell with all of them, especially Angela. She's just jealous now that she's no longer the breadwinner amongst us. For the longest, Angela got to sweep in and take care of any financial mishaps that occurred in our family. Everyone looked up to her, even my children. They love their Aunt Angie. And now that she's no longer the richest sister, she's crushed. I just know it killed her to see me get out of my new ride. I made my way to Blue's school to pick her up and take her back to the hotel. I wanted her to spend a lot more time with me so that she wouldn't pick up any more of her mother's filthy habits. Her mother was going to be the cause of her not going to college, and that was not going to happen on my watch. Blue was going to school without any debt and without any babies. As I maneuvered through the rush hour traffic, I received a call. When I checked my dashboard, I noticed that it was Rayshawn's prison. I accepted the collect call to speak to my oldest baby. Hey, baby, I answered. Sup, mama, how are you? I'm doing well. How's it going in there? It's all right. I just need a few dollars to get me through. I got you, baby. We chatted for a few minutes before we hung up. It pained me to know that my oldest son was in prison for life. He accidentally killed a girl that he was dating. He said that he only meant to scare her, not hit her so hard that she flew back and hit her head on the floor so hard that she died. Girl, your son pushed that fucking girl or about socked her in the fucking face now. We're going to call a thing what the fuck the thing is, bitch. I swear, some of these women ain't nothing but trouble. They run their mouths so much but can't take it when a man puts them in their place. Okay, here we go. Now we see what we got. Now he was doing life for a mistake. Well, I bet you he won't make that mistake again, bitch. I wished I could take it away for him, but the only thing I could do was make sure that he had money on his books. And now that I've hit the lottery, there wasn't no waiting until payday to do so. Rayshawn, Stefan, and Evan never had to wait for payday again. Mama was going to take good care of them while they were behind bars. And as for Stefan and Evan, they would be okay when they came home. I was going to make sure that I set them up real nice. I was going to get them their own condos and new cars. Then I was going to make sure they had an education and a trade to keep up with their lifestyles. They needed my help, and I was determined to be a better mother to them now that I had the resources to do so. Well, you better hope they robbing asses don't rob the fuck out of you, bitch. When I arrived at the school, I called Blue to let her know that I was out back. Within 10 minutes, she was swaggering towards my door. She had shades on to block the late afternoon sun. How was school? I asked. It was cool. Any problems with that boy? Nope, she answered. You hungry? Not really. I'll be later, though, she said. Her mood was different. I couldn't put a finger on it, but she was much more mellow than usual. I didn't pay it no mind, though. She's a teenager, and they tend to be moody. Besides, she may have had a rough day at school and didn't want to talk about it. I respected her wishes and pulled away from the school. While we rode back to my hotel, y'all, instead of R-O-D-E, oh, she put R-O-A-D. What in the entire fuck? Okay. I thought about Mr. Gaines. He hadn't called me, and I was truly disappointed. But since I'm a lady, I refuse to call him first. At this age, I don't chase men. I'm the one to be chased. As fine as I am, I'll never chase a man again. They're all lucky to even be in my presence. When we arrived at my hotel room, Blue planted herself on the sofa in front of the TV. She then pulled out her notebook and began to do homework. That's right. Spending time with Grandma was getting her back into tip-top shape. I made my way to the little desk in the room where I pulled out my iPad. Celeste sent me some new photos of finishings and furniture she wanted me to review and approve. As I sifted through the pictures, a smile stretched across my face. Sorry, y'all. Hold on. Okay. I had to be careful because I thought I saw a spider. Oh my God, y'all know I have arachnophobia like a motherfucker. And spider bite PTSD, goddamn. All right. As I sifted through the pictures, a smile stretched across my face. I was finally getting the home I always dreamed of. No more tattered carpet, outdated white appliances, and closets that I couldn't walk in and lay down in. I was building a closet the size of my hotel suite. All of my appliances would be stainless steel. Marble, hardwood, and Persian rugs are where my feet will step. I had to thank Daddy for visiting me in that dream and giving me those lottery numbers. He came back to me in his death. I knew that I was his favorite. None of my sisters ever dreamed about him. Only I did. As I continued to swipe through pictures, I received a phone call from an unrecognized number. "This is Ms. Jones," I answered. "Good afternoon, Ms. Jones. This is Mr. Gaines from Henley High. Now, didn't we talk about that, Khalil?" "Yes, but you answered the phone, Ms. Jones." "Honey, I didn't recognize the number, but what do I owe the pleasure? I'm calling about two things." "Uh-huh," I replied as I sat the iPad down. I placed both my elbows on the desk while adjusting the phone to my ear to hear him better. "First, I'm disappointed that Blue didn't show up for detention. In fact, she wasn't in school today, according to attendance records." "What?" I jumped to my feet, stunned. I was ready to go in the other room and beat her. "Yeah, I don't understand. I just picked her up. Sometimes the kids leave campus and then come back right as school lets out. Because she skipped school, she's going to be required to do community service on the weekend for at least 3 weekends in a row. We no longer suspend students because we don't want them missing learning opportunities. I understand. I'm so frustrated and disappointed in her. I have a firm talk with her. Thank you for letting me know. I have to go now. Wait a second. There was something else that I wanted to talk to you about," he spoke, just as I pulled the phone away from my ear. "What is it?" I was heated and seeing red. I couldn't believe the types of choices Blue was making. She was heading in the wrong direction and she needed to be saved ASAP. "Well, this is a little bit more personal. It may not be the right time. Angry at my granddaughter, I didn't even hear what he was saying. Just spit it out. I hope this isn't appropriate." "Wait, what?" "I think he meant inappropriate. I hope this isn't inappropriate, but I can't stop thinking about you since you walked out of my office yesterday. You had so much grace in class, and I wanted to know if I could take you out sometime. Because she put some soon. How do you take somebody out some soon? The fuck? Anyway, his deep voice warmed my ear, forcing me to settle back down into the chair. "Oh, well, I'm flattered. What day were you thinking?" "How's tomorrow? I can pick you up, take you somewhere really nice. You look so fly yesterday, and I want to see more of that," he crooned. "Tomorrow's perfect. 8 p.m.? Works for me. Text me your address, and I'll be there." "Okay, will do. Now, let me go handle my granddaughter." "Go easy on her. I doubt that. Have a good evening, Khalil." As soon as I hung up the phone, I marched into the living room area. Blue's eyes were layered, focused on her. I think she meant laser-focused. She put layered focus. Laser focused on her phone that was glued to both her paws. Without warning, I snatched the phone out of her hands and lunged it to the floor. "What the hell, Grandma?" she barked, then looked up. What the hell is wrong with you? You skipped school and detention. What the hell were you thinking? Ugh, the vice principal called. Mr. Gaines called. Of course he did, she said as she rolled her eyes. He was doing his job because you didn't do yours. All you had to do was go to school and then go to detention. But instead, you were skipping. Who did you skip with? That nappy-headed boy you had oral sex with in the bathroom the other day? Huh? Ugh, it's none of your business. It won't happen again, she hissed. Damn right it won't happen again. You are on punishment. No phone, no shopping, no G-Wagon ever. Nothing. You are cut off for good. You want to end up like Simone? Go right ahead. Waste your intelligence and beauty to go to work in a raggedy dollar store. I fussed at her before turning off the TV. I picked up her phone and decided to hold on to it. There was no way I was giving it back, and I doubt her mother would buy a new one for her because that heifer was broke. When I got back to my room, I texted Simone to tell her what her daughter was up to, but she hadn't responded. I figured she was still at work, but when she came to pick Blue up, we were going to have a serious talk about the path she was going down. A couple of hours had passed when I heard a knock on my door. Grandma? What, Blue? She opened the door and pressed her body inside. Can I order room service? I'm hungry. Yeah, go ahead. Order me a filet mignon, baked potato, and Caesar salad, I replied, waving her off. Okay. An hour later, our food was delivered. Together, we ate in the living room area of the suite. It was hard for me to even look at her. I was so upset at the decision she was making. Someone had to break the generational curse. I didn't want her to have a baby while she was young, but that was the road she was headed down. This is Simone's fault for not being a better mother. Simone acted like her girlfriend rather than her mother, and it was to Blue's detriment. Finally, Simone knocked on the door. I couldn't wait to have a serious talk with her and Blue at the same time. However, as soon as I opened the door, I knew something was wrong. Simone's face was bruised and she stunk. Marijuana and liquor poured out of her pores as she stood in the doorway, swaying from side to side. Are you out of your mind? Get in here! I pulled her by her arm and forced her into my room. No, come on, Blue. Her words were slurred. You are not driving like this. You're drunk. Go lay your ass down. And what happened to you? None of your business, she hissed. You are the reason why your daughter is a mess now. Unbelievable. Go sit down somewhere. You ain't driving like that so you can kill yourself and Blue, I barked. Mama, what happened to you? Blue asked as Simone crashed on the sofa next to her. Y'all are gonna drive me crazy, I said, as I snatched Simone's keys out of her hand. I then made my way to my room where I closed the door. Both of them were messed up, and I had to do something to fix it. Simone was beyond repair, but there was still hope for Blue. She just had to be willing to receive my help. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. This is crazy. Oh, I see y'all talking shit in the chitty chat. Wait a minute. Buck said, I took one phone call and it went from sex to do you eat it or snort it? These books move. Yes, they do. You can't fuck and listen, Buck. You got to do one or the other, boo. Oh, my God. So Cece said, I'm mad she's ready to spend money on her criminal-ass sons, but is hard on her daughter and won't help her financially. She needs to keep that energy with all of them. Child, you know that's what these mamas do out here. Coddle their fucking sons and fucking raise their daughters. And it's supposed to be the other way around. But listen, no, I don't understand it. I talk till I'm blue in the face. It don't fucking work because they don't fucking hear me. So there you go. Hey, Sweetly Blunt. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right. Yeah, she high as fuck. Lenora says, sis, higher than giraffe coochie. Okay. Right. Showed up to pick her daughter up. Okay. And thought she was going to drive home and she high as an eagle's asshole. No, God. Let me get this damn timestamp because this child, a mess, a whole mess. So Kay said, but it also stems from her relationship with her mother on how she treats her daughter, right? Absolutely true. Yep. It keeps going and keeps going. People keep trying to do the opposite or they do the absolute same and don't even realize it. They think they doing something different, but child, they ain't. Chapter 9. Simone. The next morning. The fuck was I saying? The next morning, when I woke up, I laid in the dark living room with my eyes open, thinking about everything that happened yesterday. The blackout curtains were drawn tightly so that not even an inch of light could permeate and greet my eyelids. My head throbbed from the amount of liquor I drank last night, trying to numb myself from the pain and embarrassment. What was I thinking, driving over here drunk? I must have been out of my mind, and now Mama thought even worse of me. If that were somehow possible. She's never thought highly of me. She's always told me I wasn't pretty enough or smart enough. The banging in my head was driving me crazy. I was in desperate need of some water and a Tylenol and something with a lot of carbs, like a loaf of bread. My stomach was sour and hungry at the same time. Misery traveled from my head down to my toes as I laid on the pull-out sofa, staring up at the darkness. My life was a mess. Nothing was going well. A lonely tear fell from my eye as I thought of the events of yesterday. Had I not been messing with a married man, that would have never happened. Dion's wife and her friends whooped my ass in front of my co-workers. How was I ever going to face them again? Rise and shine, the both of you, I heard my mama's voice in the dark. She walked over to the window and drew the curtains back. A flood of sunlight came rushing into the room, burning my eyes and causing my head to ache even more. Damn, Ma, I shouted. Ain't nobody tell you to get pissy drunk? Get up, the both of you, she shouted. Blue was laying on a rollout cot, still in her uniform. She wiped her eyes and sat up looking around the room. She looked as if she were lost, like she didn't remember where she slept last night. I need some water, I announced. My mouth felt like the Sahara. Every time my tongue moved, I was afraid that it would crack into dust. There's Pellegrino in the refrigerator. I don't want sparkling water, I replied. Well, that's all I drink these days. You're welcome to the faucet, she replied flippantly. Annoyed, I got up and grabbed one of the cups next to the coffee maker. I filled the cup with water from the faucet and washed it down my throat. Then I turned to look at my mother, who was standing in the center of the room, dressed in a black Versace robe. On her head was a silk bonnet, and her feet a pair of Versace house shoes. She stood with her hands on her hips, looking at me full of judgment while shaking her head. What? I grimaced. You are disgusting. You're hungover. You stink. I can't believe you wanted to drive your daughter home drunk. Come on, Grandma, lay off of her. She clearly had a rough day at work. That was my baby. She was always looking out for me, but she put she as always looking out for me. What the fuck? I don't care how rough her day was. It doesn't warrant her coming over here like that. And furthermore, you need to hush up. You're on a direct path to end up just like her. Hearing her say those words caused heat to spread throughout my body. I was so tired of her mouth, always putting me down. Fuck you, I blasted. Fuck me. Oh, no, sweetheart. Your whole life is fucked. And now it's affecting your child. Do you know she skipped school yesterday? Yeah, she didn't show up. That's 2 strikes this week. The situation with that boy and now skipping school. Sounds familiar, don't it? Sounds a lot like you, she replied while rolling her eyes. She strolled towards the coffee machine and began to brew a pot. You skipped yesterday? I needed a day to myself, Blue replied. You can't skip school. You have to graduate with honors to prove this woman wrong, I shouted. I was beside myself, filled with rage. She doesn't have to prove me wrong. She needs to want better for herself. She needs to want better than the life I've lived and better than the one you're living. Blue, if you keep down this road, you'll be wandering around drunk as a skunk, just like your pathetic mama. You have choices. Make the right one. Oh, and Simone, I took her phone. I put her on punishment, but it's up to you to reinforce it. If you keep acting like her little friend, then y'all will be little friends working at the same dollar store side by side, Mama smirked. My heart was pounding in my chest, ready to jump out onto the table. Though I hated my mother with all of my heart, she was right. I had to do something about Blue. I didn't want her living this kind of life. I didn't want her getting beat up in front of the Dollar Tree because she slept with some woman's man. So I can't get my phone back? Blue asked. No, my mother and I both said at the same time. When we both said it, we looked at each other. And for once in my life, I saw her give me the look of approval. 20 minutes later, Blue and I were heading home. She sat in the passenger seat with her lip poked out as I drove with a splitting headache. We had a battle over the radio. She wanted to turn the music up louder, probably to drown out her thoughts. I wanted to keep it low because the vibrations made my head thump. What if there's an emergency at school or something? I can't be without a phone, Blue whined. You should have thought about that before you cut school. You could have had an emergency off campus, and I wouldn't have known about it because you weren't where you were supposed to be. Oh, that makes no sense. I need a damn phone. You and grandma are crazy. Everybody skips school. So you're everybody now. You want to be average like everybody? Everybody doesn't have good grades like you do. Everybody doesn't have a rich grandmother who wants to give you the world. Do you know who I could have been if I had the shit you have access to? You could have had a G-Wagon while your mama is stuck driving this Honda Civic. You don't realize how blessed you are. Whatever, this is just not fair. What am I supposed to do all weekend? Read the Bible, because you cannot go hang out with Sharmika. You can't watch TV, and you're definitely not getting that phone back. The chorus of tooth sucking ached my head even more. I hated when I had to discipline her. I'd much rather us be on good terms, but she didn't want to act right. Mama was right about one thing, though. If we didn't nip this in the bud, she would end up like me. And I wasn't having that. She had too much potential. I wasn't sure how I was going to monitor her today, since I had to go to work later. I had no idea how I was going to go back in there and do a good job, especially after I was seen getting beat up in the parking lot. Tears stung my eyes just thinking about my most embarrassing moment ever. When we got in the house, Blue ran to her room and slammed the door shut. I ain't even have the energy to force her to hand over her laptop. Instead, I made my way to the bathroom to take a shower. I just wanted to wash yesterday off of me so that I could move on. Just as I ran the water, my phone went off. It was the Dollar Tree. What the hell could they possibly want? Did one of the workers not show up? Did they want me to come in earlier? I would have to tell them no. I was still hungover and needed the time to nurse myself back to health. Hello? I answered the phone. Hi, Simone. This is Arnold. Hi, Arnold. What's going on? I wanted to talk to you about what happened yesterday, as well as your job performance. Uh-huh, I said as I sat on the toilet to listen closely. We've received a few complaints about your attitude from customers. Other co-workers have also noticed that you come into the store smelling of marijuana. And then the fight yesterday. The fight wasn't my fault. I was jumped. We looked at the footage from the camera outside the store. She was walking away when you attacked her. But listen, Simone, we're letting you go. Please return your store keys today. Your last check will be in the mail. Wait, what? Tears began to ease down my face. This couldn't be happening to me. How could I get fired right now? I needed this job. The room began to spin and chunks of nothingness rose to my throat. I am sorry. I'll see you later today when you return your keys. Fuck! I cried when the reality settled. I was without a job. This shit wasn't fair. How was I gonna handle everything now? I quickly hopped into the shower to rinse the stench and beating off of me. The shower water mixed with my tears swirled down the drain. When I was finished, I dried off and went downstairs to make breakfast for us. Scrambled eggs, pancakes, and bacon. The aroma filled the home. I hoped it pushed my negative thoughts out. There was a part of me that wanted to get a gun and go shoot Arnold, but I decided against that. I would just go deliver the keys and move on with my life. There were other jobs out there. I just had to get on the ball and find one. After I made breakfast, I called for Blue to come eat. I'm not hungry, she yelled down the stairs. She will be eventually. At some point, her anger at me will dissipate and she'll want something to eat. Ignoring her stubbornness, I sat down and started munching. The food immediately soothed the sourness in my stomach. And now that I'd eaten, I could take Tylenol. I had a sensitive stomach, and it irritated me to take Tylenol without food. Charlie irritates anybody to take food or take that shit without food. They just don't even realize it. After popping the pill down my throat, I sat down and called my mother to tell her I was fired. I prayed this would trigger her to be more generous with her money because I've been in need of help. This is Ms. Jones, she answered the phone. Can you please stop answering the phone like that when you see it's me calling? What do you want? She ignored my request. I lost my job. Of course you did. With the way you smelled and looked, I need your help. Of course you do. Please, Mama, stop being like that. I need help. I've already given you my home. I still have other bills. Okay, fine. I'll give you $400 a month until you get a new job. Are you serious? That's it? Take it or leave it, she replied. Fine. Thank you. You're welcome, she said before hanging up. I officially hated that bitch. If I was one of her rotten sons, she would have given me way more money. It's because I'm a woman. It's because she sees herself in me. She hates herself, which is why she hates me. She's always treated me like this. If Rayshawn, Stefan, or Evan was home, they would probably be living in new condos. I know when they call for money, she's quick to put it on their books. But when she sees me, her only daughter, struggling, she can't even bother to give me real help. If I could kill that bitch and take all her cash. But if I did that, I would have to split it amongst my siblings, which wouldn't be so bad. It would still be way more money than I've ever had. I'm not about that murder life, but one day, if she pushed me too far, I could be. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, Linda. This lady done lost her damn job because she chose to fuck another woman's husband and get beat the fuck up at work. All that lady said was stay the fuck away from my husband and don't come to my house. And this heifer grabs her and then proceeds to get beat the fuck up. And now she done lost her damn job. Oh, well, I don't even know what to say. Hold on, y'all. I don't even know what the hell this is. How do people just fucking add you to their group? On Instagram. That is fucking stupid. Like, bitch, don't pick my name to add to your nasty ass group. Anyway, people so fucking stupid. Hey, Felicia, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. She said, I'm catching up, but happy Valentine's Day, fam bam. Happy Valentine's Day to you as well, darling. All right, let me get this next time stamp. I hope all of y'all got some chocolate or something, child, for today. And if you ain't got nobody to give you some chocolate, buy that shit for yourself. But eat it in moderation, child. Because that shit'll kill you, too. Chapter 10, Donetta. It's of no surprise to me that my lazy daughter couldn't keep a job. I saw that one coming a mile away. Whatever happened to her yesterday that had her bruised and drunk was of her own doing. I know my child and I know what she's capable of. It's too bad that my precious granddaughter had to suffer because her mother couldn't get it together. And then she had the nerve to ask me for money. Do I look like a fool? She'll not be getting handouts from me so that she can spend it on liquor and weed. I knew that's exactly where the money would go. She wasn't getting any more than $400 a month out of me. She already got a renovated townhouse. The mortgage was paid for. All she had to do was handle the taxes, utilities, maintenance, and the home association fee. And that did not equal to more than $400 a month. But this will put fire under her ass to get a new job quickly. I refused to let her rely on me. For the rest of the day, I got prepared for my date with Khalil. This meant a trip to the spa to get the works. I got the deluxe facial that included face steaming, exfoliation, masks, and a face massage. For my body, I got a seaweed wrap, a massage, exfoliation, and wax. My skin was as soft as a newborn infant. I didn't plan on giving Khalil any of my kitty, but I wanted to be prepared in case it went that route. He was going to be surprised at how polished and softened I was. I bet those young girls he deal with don't even look as good as I do naked. Whoever said you're not ugly, just broke, wasn't lying. I used to look so rough, saggy, and dried up, but now I'm polished and lifted to perfection. After my spa day, I went to the mall to pick out something for my date. Since he said we were going somewhere nice, I settled on a red bodycon dress that I saw in Nordstrom. It hugged my new curves just right. I had the perfect gold strappy Bottega Veneta shoes to go with it. None of those young hoes he messes with are as fly as me. I just know it. Once I was done shopping, I treated myself to a Cinnabon in the middle of the mall. As soon as I got to the food court, my eyes laid on one of my sisters, Maya. She was with her son, Malcolm, who was about 16 years old. Rather than be rude and ignore them, I decided to walk over and say hi. Hey, Maya and Malcolm, I called out to them when I approached. Maya looked down at my Nordstrom bag and smirked before her eyes met mine. Out shopping again? Yep. That's how I like to kill my free time. Just as selfish as the day you were born. Can I go to GameStop? Malcolm asked to break free of the awkward conversation. Yes, his mother replied. Quickly, he scurried away to the video game store, which was several feet behind us. Y'all need to let go of that selfish bullshit, I said as I adjusted my purse on my shoulder. How can we, when you're willing to let Mama deteriorate, even though you have the means to help her? Did Mama help me? Since Daddy died, she's blamed me for his death. So no, I'm not helping her. Respect is earned and not given. That's absolutely right, young lady. What about us? We've helped you. Yes, and if Malcolm needed anything, I would give it. He needs money for school. Consider it taken care of. You get into a bind? Sure, but Mama can go to hell, and I mean that. That's it. I'm done. Good luck to you, but even with all the money in the world, you're still going to be miserable, Maya said before stomping away. Miserable and fabulous, I yelled out while laughing. After that sour encounter, I went back to the hotel. I was tired of my siblings telling me how to feel and what I should do with my lottery winnings. This was my money, and if I wanted to spend it all on shoes, that's my prerogative. If I wanted to go out and buy a pool of caviar to swim in, it's my prerogative. If I wanted to get lawyers to appeal my son's convictions, that's my right. What I wasn't going to do was spend money on my bitch of a mother. There was a part of me that enjoyed watching her suffer. Seeing her body shake and twitch like she was in a constant earthquake was funny to me. I knew that it shouldn't be, but it was. She was so mean to me growing up. My sisters could get whatever they wanted out of her. But when it came to me, nada. So, fuck her. She deserved to die as miserable as she made me. And there's a break in the chapter. Okay, I just saw somebody. All right. Hey, Shakayla, welcome, darling. She said, hey, girl, hey, was just stopping by to say hello. I'm finishing up His Love Was Law. I gotta say thank you, Saki, because you definitely get me through my work days. Well, you're welcome, darling. And make sure you like the video before you leave, girl, and go back to the other book. But I appreciate you being here. All right, let me get back to it. I stood in front of the mirror, smoothing out my dress. As I reveled in my reflection, I turned to the side. Khalil was not going to be able to keep his eyes nor his hands off of me. My cleavage looked like a pair of pillows ready to be snuggled. My waist was snatched. My skin was glowing, courtesy of my spa day, and the body lava luminizer by Fenty. Well, that's a mouthful. Lava luminizer. Okay. With the gold open-toe shoes laced up my nice legs that were toned, thanks to training with Jordan, I was ready to step out and meet my new boo. Something told me that Khalil and I would hit it off. At 8 p.m. on the dot, he was there knocking on my door. I sauntered to open up, and when I did, I was greeted by his gorgeousness as well as his Tom Ford cologne. The aroma wafted to my nose, pulling me in. I had half the man to pull him into my hotel suite and rip his clothes off, but my whorish days were well behind me. I was determined to act like the lady I've become. You look amazing. That color looks so good against yours. You scared the fuck out of me. Damn. I swear, I think you motherfuckers is trying to kill me. That's what I think. Seriously, you're just popping up like a nigga in the box. Oh, Lord have mercy. One second, y'all. Damn. All right, y'all. Sorry about that. Jasmine said, not me thinking that was part of the book. No. Oh, my God. Y'all, these men just be walking up on me and shit. Sneaking up on me because I got my headphones on. They don't make no noise loud enough for me to know that they black asses is coming. And then I'm sitting up here jumping out of my damn body. Lord, have mercy. It's just like you don't know when you like a jack in the box. I call him a nigga in the box. All right. You look amazing. That color looks so good against your skin, he complimented as he reached out for my hand and brought it to his lips. Your style definitely complements mine, I smiled. Are you ready? I'm starving and I can't wait for you to try Chima. It's a Brazilian steakhouse. Have you been there? Not that one, but I've been to Fogo de Chão. Oh, it's similar, but much better. I'm ready. Together, we walked out of the hotel to his ride. It was a silver C-class. Not bad for someone who works in the public school system. I was impressed. The car was clean and smelled good, and like a gentleman, he opened the door for me. By the time we got to the restaurant, I was fully at ease. We talked the entire time, but not about anything deep. The convo was lighthearted as we got the pleasantries out of the way. Once we were sitting across from each other, I intended to ask the hard questions. When we were inside, he pulled the chair out for me. Finally, we ordered a bottle of champagne and allowed the bubbles to unwind our tongues. First things first, you got a wife, girlfriend, baby mama? I asked after completing a glass of champagne. No, no, and yes. So he has a baby mama. So no wife, y'all, no girlfriend, but he does have a baby mama. Oh, Lord have mercy. Okay. Yes to the baby mama? Yes, I have a daughter, Amira. She's 9 years old, currently in the hospital sick with cancer. She lives with her mother in California. That's where I went to school. Oh my God, I'm so sorry to hear that, I said, while extending my hand to his. Our eyes met, and I could see the grief spilling from his. That was such an awful thing to go through, a sick child. That poor baby was too young to be burdened with something like that. Yeah, it's been a rough road. She has leukemia, but she's been fighting like a champ. How often do you go to see her? I fly out there every other week. If I could afford it, I'd move out there to be with her, but it's been hard to find a job that pays the same. I have it pretty good at Henley High. I've noticed, I smiled as I eyed the gold watch on his wrist. The nice car, designer clothes, and expensive cologne were all signs that he was doing well for himself. And the insurance, it covers a lot of her treatments. What's the prognosis? I asked as I lifted the glass for another sip. It's grim, but we're keeping hope alive. This is a picture of her before she got sick, he said, holding up his phone. She looked just like him. Same beautiful smile and clear complexion. She's gorgeous. Thank you. That's my baby. But enough about my sad story. What about you? I know you got a man or at least a jealous ex-husband somewhere with as fine as you are. I'm single, honey. I've had 6 children. Stop lying. He leaned back and eyed me up and down. My body left no evidence of the children I have had, courtesy of Dr. Rodriguez in the Dominican Republic. I'm serious. 5 boys and 1 girl. They're all grown and out of my hair, I replied. How many grandchildren do you have? Too many to count, I laughed. My 3 older sons have about 3 to 4 children each. They're a bit reckless. My other 2 sons don't have children, and my daughter only has the one that goes to your school. Blue. Blue is my only granddaughter. He nodded his head while pulling the glass of golden bubbles to his lips. I watched as he sipped, thinking about what it would be like for those lips to be on me. Khalil was a work of art, tall, strong, statuesque. He had the posture of a king and a voice of a god. I wonder what led him to working in a high school. Tell me about yourself. What made you choose education? He set the glass down and leaned back in the chair. It sort of chose me. I was drafted into the basketball association right out of college, but after 2 years of playing, I got injured pretty badly. It ended my career. I went through a depression for 2 years. That led me to gambling and drinking. At first, I had some big wins, but then I had some even bigger losses. I lost most of the money I made playing ball. I came back home and someone invited me to coach a rec center's basketball team. I was opposed at first, but decided to do it. It went well. That same friend linked me with the school board and now here I am. Wow, I'm so sorry about the injury and your sick baby. You've been through a lot. That's life. It's filled with ups and downs. It's the little things like getting hugs from my daughter or when one of the guys on the team gets into a D1 school. Or having dinner with the most beautiful woman I've ever seen that makes life worth living, he said while looking me deeply in the eyes. I became flushed with flattery. He had a way with words that were much better than my boy toy Jordan. Thank you, Khalil. Of course, I hope that our age difference, listen, I got an old soul and you got a youthful soul. We cancel each other out. Age ain't nothing but a number anyway. It's just used to keep us divided and from connecting to one another. We both have things to learn from one another, he replied, causing my heart to thump. Child, listen. Every word that reached out of his sexy lips pulled me in. I was completely enthralled by him. Dinner came and went. We ate, but we mostly engaged in conversation. I never wanted the night to end. In all my 51 years, the only other delightful experience I've had with a man has been with Daddy. Daddy used to make me feel one of a kind. He took me to nice eateries. Sure, it was when he was on dates with other women, but I didn't care. I was just so excited to be there with him. And now I was excited to be there with Khalil. After dessert, he took me back home to the hotel. "Do you want to come in?" I offered. Earlier in the night, I wasn't trying to give it up, but now I had to have him. My entire body was craving for his touch. "I'd love to, Donetta. You can call me Donnie." "Donnie, I have a personal training session with a client in the morning." "You do personal training too?" "Yeah, for professional athletes. This guy plays on the Nationals, but I want nothing more than to take you in there and make love to you. I know we just met, but you're the kind of woman I can see myself with forever." "Oh, stop." I pushed him away. "I'm serious. You're smart, regal, classy. Nothing like the women I've met before. And I've met all kinds of women playing ball. But you have this sexy maturity about you. I want to know all of you. I can see myself growing with you." "Well, we have to have another date then," I smiled. "Definitely. I'll call you tomorrow. Good night." "Good night," I replied. But he leaned forward and grabbed me by the lips. The feel of his hands pressing into my hips made me want to drag him inside of my hotel room, but I had discipline. Our lips collided with our tongues meeting for the first time. They said more in that kiss than they did the entire conversation at Chima's. When he pulled away, I felt as if I were thrusted out of heaven and back to the real world. "Look how hard you got my dick from a kiss," he said, while pulling my hand to his crotch. The feel of his weighty, rock-solid dick was so tempting, but I knew better than to get in the middle of a man and his hustle. I stroked his shaft and thought about all the nasty things I wanted to do with him. "Wow, you didn't have to tell me. I just wanted to leave you with something to think about," he winked. "You mean something to obsess about. Trust me, I'll be obsessing too. I'll call you later, Donnie," he said, while kissing my forehead. I watched him turn and walk away. It wasn't until he was at the elevator that I decided to open my door and go back into my room, where I plopped down on the bed. I laid there looking at the ceiling, thinking about how my dreams had finally come true. Nothing could knock me off of cloud nine. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, here we go. Irk and Jerk is in the building. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, y'all. I think we are at the part where we all say goodbye to one another, honey. Because, if this were one of those shorter books, child, it would be that, it's just like an hour left in the book, right? But not this book, baby doll. This book has some meaty chapters. Some very meaty chapters. I mean, I know we like the meatiness, but not in the chapters. Oh, Lord. So I am going to bid you guys a good night and a happy Valentine's Day all around. Girl, wifey, I hope this man ain't finna suck her bank account dry, because that would just be absolute trash. But we know how these niggas are, so he may be getting ready to suck her bank account dry. He might be, child. Listen. So yeah, y'all. Y'all have a great rest of the Valentine's Day, you know, because it's not over yet for at least another 5 hours. Well, 4 hours and 57 minutes is what you got left on the clock for Valentine's Day, right? Because it's 7:03 here. Unless you live out there in Weirdo Land, in which case, yeah. You got 6 hours left, damn it. Yeah. 6 hours and 57 minutes. All right. So listen, thank you, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. I truly appreciate all of your hard work, darling. And you guys, I thank y'all for showing up for me. All right. And I appreciate y'all listening to me read out loud. And I hope I left y'all feeling better than you were when you got here. Y'all have a good night. I love y'all. And until next time, please remember to salute your spirit and protect your peace. Bye, y'all. You ain't shit, Buck. Go to hell. Bye, y'all.